Namantre Nama. Morning to all. Myself, Dr. Vinayak Malik, Assistant Professor, Tamil Arithmetic College, Dedar. Welcome you everybody. It is with a tremendous pleasure that I welcome you all for our first national seminar on Market Shilya Tantra 2020. Fear is the most powerful tool mankind. Right? So before we start with any good things, first your faith of the God. So with this, I'll call upon our staff to grace this occasion.
Hello, good morning to all. Myself, Dr. K.V. Kulur, Department of Dravaguna, Ramina Ayurvedic Medical College, Eda. Sri Bahubali, J.V. Mandala, Ramina Ayurvedic College, Eda, welcomes you all. Update Shalya Tantra 2020. It's my pleasure to welcome our chief patrons of this online webinar. Sri D.C. Patil sir, Chairman Gramina Ayurvedic Medical College Cherdal, Sri Dr. J.P. Algur sir, Gramina Ayurvedic Medical College Cherdal, Sri Nilesh Desai sir, Azra Gramina Ayurvedic Medical College Cherdal, welcome you sir. I would like to welcome our beloved principal, professor and HOD Department of Panchakarma and president of this online seminar. Welcome you, sir. I would like to extend my welcome to Organizing Secretary Dr. Taj N. Dongargam, sir, Associate Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Gramina Ayurvedic Medical College, Tehsildar. On the behalf of the entire institute, I would like to welcome today's special guest speakers, Dr. Amruta Wali Madam, Associate Professor, Department of Prasuti Tantra, PG Studies in Prasuti Tantra, B.M. Kankanwadi Ayurvedic Mahavidyalaya Belagavi, and another speaker, Dr. Suprang Sharma sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Jammu Institute of Ayurveda and Research. Welcome you, sir. I also like to welcome our teaching staff, non-teaching staff, and hospital staff and students of Gramina Ayurvedic Medical College. Finally, I like to welcome all the faculty members, practitioner, UG students, PG scholars of different colleges, and audience from the different parts of the country. Welcome you all.
Thank you, ma'am. Let's begin our session. I request Kulur ma'am for the introduction of today's guest speaker, Dr. Amruta Wali ma'am.
I am very happy to introduce Dr. Amruta Wali Madam. Dr. Amruta Wali Madam, born on 13th February 1987, Madam has completed BMS degree from Acharya Deshbhushan Ayurvedic Medical College, Badkihal, District Belgaum, and completed MS in KLE Academy of Higher Education, 3 BM Kankanwadi Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya, Belagavi. and currently working as associate professor department of pg studies in chalatantra kle academy of higher education sri bm kankanwari ayurveda mahavidyalaya belagavi and madam guided many pg and ug dissertation and awarded for best dissertation by kle university madam completed pg diploma in yoga therapy shivaji university of kolhapur Chara Agnikarma Menon for the 5th World Ayurveda Conference and the Arogya Expo. Madam did many publications in national and international journals. Thank you, Madam. Over to you, Madam.
Hello.
Madam, am I audible, madam?
Yeah, sir. Yeah, I'll just. Sir, is my PPT is visualizable?
Madam, it is visible.
Yeah. Shall I start?
Okay, madam.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Respected teachers, faculty members, practitioners, and students. I, Dr. Amruta Wali, associate professor from Kaher Sri B.M. Kankanwadi Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya Belagavi. So today I am dealing with the topic relievation of raktamokshana. So when you heard a word raktamokshana, we can say it is a very unique and efficient treatment which can be adopted in many treatment modalities. So particularly in case of acute pain conditions in Ayurveda, because if you see nowadays, many pain management clinics are running with the help of raktamokshana. So these are the contents of my slide, which I'm going to see in I'll deal with in further presentation. Coming to the introduction. As you know that Acharya Shushruta has contributed many surgical and parasurgical procedure, among which due importance is given to the raktamokshana. It is a unique contribution by him, that is Acharya Shushruta. The surgical procedure of allowing the blood to bleed for therapeutic purposes is known as raktamokshana, that is bloodletting. Raktasya mokshanam raktasravam. It is indicated in various diseases, as it is an exceptional parasurgical procedure which is indicated in various diseases where there is a predominance of raktadushti is in excess. Out of various raktamokshana techniques, Siraveda is considered as ardha chikitsa, that is pradhana chikitsa. Siraveda chikitsa ardha shalyatantra prakirtitah. So here ardha chikitsa we have to text in context of chikitsa madhye pradhanam ityartha, that is pradhana chikitsa in shalyatantra. Coming to the importance of rakta, it is duly said that in a surgery saving one drop of a blood is more important than transfusing one unit of a blood. And the same importance is given by Acharya Shushruta, considering rakta as a moola which does the dharan of sharira. He stated why it is considered as moola. As you know that rakta is the cause for utpatti, sthiti and pralaya. So it is present during all three stages of a life, that is utpatti, sthiti and pralaya. So that is utpatti, creation of body, where there is a sanyog of shukra and shunita, we can consider it as a bija. So during sthiti, that is maintenance, continuous flow, that is rasrakta samhan, we can consider. And during the pralaya, that is destruction, whenever there is absence of blood, that can be considered as a marana. So it is a mool of a sharira and we need to save it. Coming to the raktadushti nidanas, we can divide the raktadushti nidanas in a various parts, that is ahara, vihara, kala and mansika. Ahara janyas like ati sevan of bahu tikshna ushna ahara, ati lavana kshara ahara sevana, kulatya masha sevan, etc. Vihara we can consider as diva swapna after bhojan, chardi, vega vidharana, etc. For kala we can consider as, that is sharad kala, it's a swabhava. There will be raktadushti, and in mansika we can consider it as a krodha. Coming to the doshanusar rakta dushti lakshanas, that is vatash, pittash, kafas, sannipatas and sansrushtas. So coming to the vatash, we can get rakta dushti lakshanas as like fenila, aruna, krushna, parushatanu, etc. For pittash, neela, pita, harita, shava, etc. For kafas, gauri, kodak, pratikasham, snigdham, shitilam, etc. And sarva lakshana yuktam, we can say it is for a sannipataja. So coming to the main topic, that is indications of raktamokshana. So there are various indications which are mentioned in various context. Okay, so that is, these are vidradi, kushta, ekadeshaja shofa, visarpa, shlipada, arbuda, stanaroga, granthi, austaroga, krumidanta, kushtaroga, vishajushta, shonita and upadamsha. So these are the general indications for a raktamokshana. Coming to the contraindications for raktamokshana, that is sarvanga shofa, whenever there is a generalized swelling. So obviously in case of generalized swelling, we'll not be able to get a vein for raktamokshana. Akshina persona who has consumed amla ahara. So obviously again amla ahara will go for rakta vruddhi, rakta dushti more. And akshina person, if we do a raktamokshana, it will go for a vata vruddhi again, which will increase the severity of disease. Pandu, Arsha, Udara, Shotha and Garbhini are Shotha Pradhan Avastas, hence are considered as Avisravya. And Shvayathu, that is Ekangaja Vrana Shotha. Ekangaja Vrana Shotha is contraindicated for Raktamokshana. Coming to the types of Raktamokshana. So these are broadly divided into Shastra and Ashastra Raktamokshana. So in Shastra, we can again divide it into Siraveda and Prachana. Siraveda is nothing but vein puncturing and Prachana is nothing but making multiple incision. Ashastra, these are Shrunga, Jalauka, Alabu and Ghatiyantra. Out of which nowadays we are using the Jalauka, Shrunga and Alabu. Very rarely it is used. We are not practicing it. Out of that, Ghatiyantra, which can be compared nowadays with the cupping, that can be used. Coming to the action, so where exactly these various types of raktamokshans are indicated. So in deeply seated conditions, leech is preferable. In case of localized, that is prachanam pindite hitam. In case of localized lump, prachana is indicated. In case of generalized conditions like sira anga vyapake, so there we can go for a sira vedhana. Shrunga alabu twachisthite. So while shrunga and alabu, these are indicated where there is a disorders of a skin. So I'll come in detail here. That is, what are the methods and what are the indications? So coming to the one, that is sira vedhana. That is, vena puncturing indication is whenever there is a generalized vishesan. Tridosha dushti is there and sarvangikam avgadam. Coming to the prachana karma, that is multiple incisions. Ekadasha sthitam pinditam, that is localized lump and utthana raktam. So Acharya Shushruta has told that what kind of level you can go for a raktamokshana. So prachana is indicated in utthana raktam, where siravedana is indicated in sarvangikam avghadatamam, whenever it is very deeply situated. Coming to the jalauka, whenever there is a grathitam avghadam, very deeply situated, and pittopakam vishajam. Coming to the shrunga, wherever there is a suptata, that is numbness, vata pittam, that is more vata involvement doshas is there, and avghadatamam. And coming to the alabu, twakasthitam, whenever it is localized to the skin, kafavatam and avghadatara. So he has explained that avghadatara, avghadatama and avghada. So siravedan is indicated at sarvangikam avghadatama. Shringa is indicated at avghadatama. Alabu is indicated at avghadatara. Jalauka is indicated at avghada and prachana is indicated at uttana rakta. So for uttana rakta, whenever the doshas are deeply situated, we can go for a siravedana, jalauka, shrunga, labu, etc. And in case of uttana avastha, we can go for a prachana karma. So I'll just give an example, because some might be getting a doubt that which type of raktamokshana is used. So there are various disorders. Out of that, I'll just take an example of vata rakta, where Acharya Charaka has explained how all the treatment modality of raktamokshana can be used in vata rakta at various avasthas. So what he is explained is that jalauka is indicated whenever there is a ruk, daha, shul and todha for a patient. Also you can use for shrunga and alabu whenever there is a supti, Kandu and Chimchimayan is present. Prachanna is also can be performed when it is at one desha, and Siravedan is also indicated when the doshas are spread from one place to another place. He also said that when it is a contraindicated in Vatarakta, so he says that Anga Glanav na tu strivyam ruksho vatottare yacha. That is, whenever there is Anga Shosha is there, so you should not go for a Rakta Mokshana, because ultimately again it will increase the Vata Dosha and again the severity of disease may get increased. So that is how we can select a particular type of Rakta Mokshana depending upon the avasthas. So he said very nicely that yatha dosham yatha balam, that is, you have to think of a doshas, you have to think of a bala, and then you have to choose for a proper type of Rakta Mokshana. So I'll go in detail one by one different Rakta Mokshanas. So coming to the Siravedana, it can be considered as vena puncturing. Okay, that is bloodletting by vena puncturing. So I'll just go through the standard operative procedure which we follow in our hospital. Our hospital is the India's first institution which is accredited by NAC and the NABH. So according to the NABH rules, we have prepared this standard operative procedures and we are following this. So for Siravedana, what are the collections of that is preoperative procedure? We need some instruments before the Siravedana. That is 18 gauge needle, roller bandage, gauze piece pad, tourniquet, bandage cutting scissor, BP apparatus, kidney tray, measuring flask, sponge holding forceps, whole towel, Haridra powder, micropore plaster, Macintosh sheet, and surgical gloves. So these are the instruments we needed. Coming to the preparation of patient, so the laboratory investigations, routine blood investigations are to be performed, that is HB, TCD, CSF, and HIV 1 and 2, HBSHG, urine routine, RBS are to be get it done prior to the Siravedana. Well-informed consent is very important. If you are going to carry any kind of procedure over a patient, Snehan Svedan is to be done. It might be a Sarvanga or Sthanika Abhyanga followed by Bashpa Svedan. Teela Yavagu Pana, that is Sisam Gruel, is asked patient to drink Teela Yavagu in a sufficient quantity before 45 minutes of Siravedana. So Teela Yavagu, it is Sadhya Sneha Karak as well as Rakta Utklesha Karak. So it is given prior to the Siravedana. Monitoring of vitals. So prior to the procedure, you should record the BP, pulse with date and time is very important when you are following the NABH rules. Coming to the operative procedure, so positioning of patient. So here, according to the different diseases, Acharaj has explained the different positions for patient. So for what, which disease you are carrying the Siravedana, according to that, you have to give the position to the patient. So patient is meant to sit comfortably position on examination table. So it should be a comfortable for that patient. Apply tourniquet proximal to the site of Siravedana. A vein is made prominent by flickering the vein by index finger. Then engorged vein is made fixed by skin traction so that it will be a very fixed. Your needle will not be moved here and there. Then sterile 18 gauge needle is slowly introduced into the lumen of vein at an angle of a 15 degree from skin surface with a bevel end facing the upwards and allow blood to flow into the kidney tray. So you have to hold the kidney tray down and let it be flow on a kidney tray. Monitor the vitals of a patient with pulse oximeter and flow of blood. So you have to monitor the patient. You have to see his BP and pulse rate. Wait till blood flow stops. So Acharya Shushruta explained that by one muhurta, the blood will get automatically stops. That is within a 45 minutes. So coming to the post-operative procedure, Siravedana. When bleeding stops, a removal of needle by a sterile cotton pad and application and compression bandaging is done. Foot end elevation is given to the patient. So obviously, again, slight bleeding chances are there. So if you give a foot end elevation, that will be reduced. Rest for 10-15 minutes is given and vitals are to be monitored. So patient will be sometimes, he may get a panic and all. So you have to be give rest to the patient and the vitals are to be monitored. Drava and Ghrita Pradhana Ahar is advised for a patient. As there will be a Vata Vruddhi, so we have to advise the Laghu Ahara for a patient post-operatively. So these are the various sites. I'll not go in detail for each disease. I'll just do some examples at what site the Siravedhan should be carried out. So in case of Vata Shonita, Pada Daha, Pada Harsha, Vata Kantaka, Chippa and Visarpa, it is said that two angul above the Kshipra Marma, you have to go for Vedhana Karma. So this is the picture in case of Vata Rakta, we are carrying out the Siravedhana Karma. Coming to the next, that is Shlipada. He said that for Vataj Shlipada, four angul above the gulf, for Pittaj, four angul below the gulf, and then for Kafaja, at Angushtamulam. Okay, then coming to the, this is for Grudrasi, that is four angul above the Janusandhi and four angul below the Janusandhi. And again for Vishwachi, that is, he explained that four angul above the Karpura Sandhi and four angul below the Karpura Sandhi. So these are the various sites and various lots of disorders are there where he has explained the site where exactly you should go for a Vyadhana Karma. Then what are the preventive measures can be taken when we follow such a procedures? That is, aseptic precautions are to be followed during the procedures. So obviously, there is a chances or a fear of an infection. So we have to be follow that aseptic precautions while performing the Siravedhana. Direct handling of blood is avoided by wearing gloves. And after the procedure, patient is observed for a vitals and bleeding at the site of application. So coming to the emergency management, if at all anything happens during the Siravedhana, how to tackle it? That is hematoma. If it happens, then you can go for a cold pack application. In case of patient landed in shock, following procedure are followed. So sometimes we can't predict such a situations comes while performing the Siravedhana, etc. So we have to be ready with the things. So if the patient landed into the shock, we have to go for sprinkling of cold water on a face and give assurance first thing. Vitals are rechecked. What is his BP? What is his pulse rate? We have to check whether proper ventilation is going on or no. And if at all BP is low, and then we have to go for a IV fluids. That is RL and can be used. Coming to the next, that is Jalauka. So it is a little blood sucker, what we can say, Jalauka Ucharana, very famous treatment nowadays, which is going on as the modern people, like we can say the contemporary science, they are doing a lot of research on this leech application. So what are the literature on leech says? It is a natural surgical instrument, as Acharya Shishruta included in Anushastra, made it used by Acharya from 2nd century onwards, and now doctor says that welcome back little blood sucker. So this term Jalauka, we can split it into Jala plus Oka, that is water dwelling animals. So the one whose life is water and the whose dwelling place is water, we can call it as a Jalauka. It is typically indicated in Pitta and Rakta Pradoshaja Vikaras. So what is the speciality of Jalauka? These Jalaukas are used for raktamokshan without pain. So Jalaukas tu sukhina raktastravaya yojayat, reference by Ashtanga Sangraham. So this leech of Jalauka, what we can predict in terms of a modern contemporary science, that is this saliva of a leech, it contains hirudin, anesthetic chemical and vasodilator, and ultimately it goes for a painless procedure. So whenever the Jalauka bites, will not be have a pain, as it is a painless procedure. So coming to the types, there are total 12 types of Jalauka, 6 Savisha and 6 Nirvisha, as you all know. So out of this, that is Nirvisha, that is Shankhamukhi Jalauka, we can compare with what we are using for a practice. That is common name is medicinal leech, and a scientific name we can call it as a Hirudo medicinalis. So this is the leech what we can use for a raktamokshana. So coming to the Jalauka Ucharan indication, so you can use for a vata rakta, shofa vidradi, pittaj visarpa, kushta, dushtavranam, pittanubandhi, pakshaghata, and then shvitra, abscess, peripheral vascular diseases, arthritis, infection, and hematoma. So these are the indications where we can go for a Jalauka Ucharana. Coming to the contraindications, HIV patients and we can't use a Jaloka because still studies going on whether it carries the virus or no. But for a safer side, we can't use patients on immunocompressive drugs and patients with bleeding tendency. Jaloka Uchan is contraindicated. Coming to the preoperative procedure for Jaloka, so instruments which are kept ready are Jaloka, roller bandage, lukewarm water, gauze piece, BP apparatus, bandage cutting scissor, kidney tray, hold towel, Haridra and Sandhava, micropore plaster, surgical gloves and 23 gauge needle. So coming to the preoperative procedure, preparation of patients. So as I said earlier, routine blood investigations are to be done. Well-informed consent is to be taken and vitals are to be monitored. Preparation of Jaloka. Jaloka which is actively moving and not used for previously 15 days is selected. Jaloka is activated by placing into the turmeric water for 5 minutes. So operative procedure. So position, sitting on, lying down, depends on a site where you are performing the Jaloka. Clean the affected part with the lukewarm water and rubbed with dry gauze as Rukshan Karma is said prior to the Jaloka. Jaloka Ucharan will be applied at a site of an indication. If the Jaloka is unable to catch or suck, then you have to make a prick with a 13 gauge needle, small prick, as one drop of blood is sufficient to catch the Jaloka. So if drop of blood comes out, the Jaloka catches very easily. Blood sucking by Jaloka is confirmed. That is, it is very nicely says that Ashva Khuravata, that is its jaw fixation to the affected part, its angulation and movement of a body. By all these three things, we can confirm that Jaloka is sucking properly. Then covered with wet cotton pad and except near the mouth of the leech, so that the leech the leech will feel that he is in a own habitat. That is what we have to cover with a cotton pad, wet cotton pad. Then coming to the removal of Jaloka, that is, observe the Jaloka for sucking of the blood. It gently leaves by its own within 45 minutes. After 45 minutes also, if the Jaloka is not leaving, okay, then remove it manually by sprinkling the Haridra or Sandhava powder over the mouth of a Jaloka. If patient complains itching, pricking pain, burning sensation at a site, it should be understood that leech is sucking pure blood and has to be removed manually. Place it in a fresh water after removal. So coming to the post-operative procedure for a patient. So dressing is done at a bite with Haridra. And in case of oozing is there, blood compression, that is bandaging is done. Patient is said to stay in a recovery room for an hour for observation. So coming to the post-operative procedure for leech, turmeric powder is applied to the mouth of the leech to vomit the sucked blood. So after this leech is placed in a fresh water, if it actively moves, then we have to say that the sucked blood has completely removed or vomited by Jaloka. If it sinks in the water, it indicates that the sucked blood had not got completely removed. And again, and hence that Jaloka is heavy and inactive. So again, we have to carry the vomiting to remove the remnant blood. So if the blood remains inside, we have to squeeze it from the tail to mouth gently to vomit the complete blood. So we have to be very precautious while doing the vomiting of the Jaloka, as we have to handle it very gentle. Vomited Jaloka is kept in turmeric water and then transferred to the fresh water. So used Jaloka will be kept in separate container and we have to label that at what date and when it was used for a patient. So coming to the preventive measures, handling of a leech, vomited blood is avoided by wearing the gloves. After the procedure, patient is observed for vitals and bleeding at a site of application. Ensure patient safety by asking any allergic conditions, pain, itching, bleb formation, etc. Then coming to the emergency management, in case of bleeding, the following steps are to be followed. Elevation, the applied, that is part is elevated for 15 to 20 minutes. Tight bandaging is to be done with Haridra Churna and dusting of Lodhra Madhukadi Churna. For a Raktastrav, Acharya Shushruta has explained the Lodhra Madhukadi Churna. One of the research is done in our institute about this Lodhra Madhukadi Churna and it has got excellent results to stop the bleeding. So these are the some pictures how you can go for a chaloka ucharna. Initially you have to activate the chaloka by putting into the haridra powder, and you can typically see how the catches the chaloka. The position is ashvakhuravata, and then you have to make the chaloka as it's in your own habitat so that it can suck the blood very nicely. So this is the carrying out the vomiting of chaloka. So what are the effect of saliva on a human body? So this chaloka has a lots of a chemical compounds which has a various effects on our body. So it is anticoagulant, vasodilating, it has a platelet aggregation inhibiting factors, clot dissolving factors, it is anti-inflammatory, bacteriostatic and analgesic. So this is a small animal and it has saliva has got lots of a effect on a human body. Then coming to the mechanism of action of chaloka, so blood clot is removed, so it improves the local circulation, venous return is increased, and speed up the reparative process. So I'll just give an example that mechanism in Buerger's disease, TAO. So in TAO, what are the features of the disease is present? There will be a hypercoagulation, and if we apply a leech, how the leech can combat this TAO, that is, it's a anticoagulant feature. So platelet hyperaggregation will be there in case of a TAO. So it will go for a platelet aggregation inhibitor, the component in a saliva of a leech. Severe peripheral vasospasm will be present in Buerger's disease, and it acts, and the leech acts as a vasodilator. Severe pain will be there in case of a Buerger's disease, and this leech has got an anesthetic effect. So whenever the leech will prick, will not be have a pain. So likewise, the leech has action on a different diseases. So this is one of the case that is RTA case has came to a casualty, and you can see there is a tear. So it is sutured, and after the suturing, on the second day, you can see the hematoma is present. So we applied a leech at a site, and we thought like how it is going to heal now. And then we thought like whether this flap is again will get removed or what. And then we thought of to use of a chaloka, and it has give excellent result and wound got healed very nicely. So nowadays, this chaloka has got a prime importance in case of like plastic surgery. The people are doing research. So whenever the graft is taking or no, so whenever the graft most of the time is rejecting, at that time, these people are trying with the chaloka so that the graft intake will be very properly takes place. So coming to the next modality, that is prachana karma. So prachana word means is to bleed by making the multiple incisions or scarifying. So it is a treatment modality to irrigate the vitiate bloods, and usually adopted as a sthanik chikitsa for utthana rakta. Typically this prachana karma is indicated, and it is indicated whenever there is a thick lesion in the skin or the tumors, etc. So coming to the preoperative procedure of prachana karma, surgical blade is used, 11 number, a roller bandage is used, whole towel, gauze piece, BP apparatus, bandage cutting scissor, betadine spirit, sponge holding forceps, tourniquet, micropore plaster, and surgical gloves is needed. So coming to the preparation, same, laboratory investigations should be carried out, well-informed consent is to be taken, vitals are to be monitored, and the sthanik abhyanga and swedan is to be done. Coming to the position of patient, make sit comfortable in a position on examination table to a patient. Painting with a betadine and spirit at a site of a prachana followed by dripping is to be done. The affected area of skin is stretched by applying the traction with the fingers, and multiple slit incisions are made over the affected area of the skin, and 11 number blade is to be used in such a way that there will be a straight line incisions without touching each other, not very deep and not very superficial, and quickly it should be performed without damaging any vital structure. So three incisions are made at an area of 1 by 1 square centimeter area. So the same research for a prachana karma is carried out in our institute, and we decided that in 1 by 1 square centimeter area, three incisions will be sufficient. So multiple incisions are made depending upon the affected area, which allows the blood to ooze out. vitals are to be monitored. So this is the collection of instrument, Prachanna Karma. Initially the tourniquet was tight and later it was removed. And this is the status dermatitis case where the Prachanna Karma is carried out. So these are the some pictures where the Prachanna Karma is carried out. So post-operatively, apply Shatadhauta Ghruta over the site of a Prachanna Karma. Patient is allowed to stay half an hour for a recovery room for observation and vitals are to be monitored. So what are the preventive measures which are to be taken is aseptic precautions are to be followed during the procedures. Handling of a blood is avoided by wearing the gloves and after the procedure, patient is opted for the vitals. So emergency management, so the same emergency management is there for all. That is, if the patient went into the shock management should be carried out. So this prachana is practically very much useful in case of alopecias, in case of eczemas like status dermatitis and folliculitis, etc. So coming to the Shrunga, Shrunga therapy. So how to be done? It's a cow's horn which is used, but nowadays we are not practicing this Shrunga. So what is the said in the text? Priorly it was in a practice, but nowadays we are not practicing it. So clean the affected part, put the Shrunga, remove the little ear first. So before Shrunga also we need to do some few incisions at the site where we have to apply the Shrunga. And again put the instrument, suck the air, hold for a minutes and then remove the Shrunga. So because of some like directly coming into contact with the blood and also nowadays we are not following this procedure. So post-operative procedure, wipe out the blood, clean the part with Trifala Kashaya, apply Durvadi Ghruta and wash Shrunga with the hot water. So these are the some pictures how the Shrungavacharan is to be carried out. So coming to the Alabu, Alabu is Langaria vulgaris. So it is a made hollow round from inside. And initially Prachan is to be done at the site of a lesion. So burning candle is kept so that the vacuum is created. It's a negative pressure will be created. Then Alabu is to be applied. So it consumes all the oxygen and vacuum is created. So this is how Ghati Yantra and in the same way the Alabu is working out. So this is the like small incision. Initially the Prachanna Karma is carried out and the cupping is applied. So instead of using Alabu and this one Shrunga etc, nowadays Ghati Yantra, this is been replaced by the cupping therapy. So various cuppings like plastics, glass, wood are available that can be used for a Raktamokshana Karma. There is an issue of sterilization. That is what nowadays these are replaced with the cupping therapy. So this is the cupping therapy which is done for a backache in our institute. So coming to the what are the merits of Raktamokshana? So Raktamokshana is one among the Panchkarma, that is Panchashodhya. That is Acharya Shushruta and Bhagavata has he has said that one of the Panchkarma is Raktamokshana. Among various Raktamokshana techniques, Siraveda is considered as Ardha Chikitsa, that is Pradhana Chikitsa, that already we have discussed. And the diseases which are not getting pacified or cured by Snehadi Panchkarma, Lepan is better to Lepan etc. It is better to cure by Siravedana. That is Snehadi Bihi Kriya Yogena Tatha Lepanahi Api Yantyashu Vyadhya Shanti Yatha Samyak Siravedana. So whenever the pain is not getting subsided by any means like Snehan Swedan by Lepan etc. So best choice is the Vyadhana Karma. So coming to the effects of Raktamokshana. So it improves the circulation. So probably it is removing the obstruction in the blood vessel and again establishment of circulation will be there. That is Margavarodhan, it will remove and it will improve the circulation. Eliminate the Vishas, the toxins. So Vishajanya Shofa is one of the indication where to eliminate the Vishas we have to go for a Raktamokshana. Increase the pooling of fresh blood. So the whatever the toxic, it's a metabolic imbalance, whatever the toxic metal will be there, that will be removed. We can consider it as an armor. So that particles will be removed, and then there will be increased fresh pooling of a blood, and it stimulates cell proliferation. So obviously, whenever there is a circulation is improved, ultimately it is going to stimulate the cell proliferation. So what are the limitations of Rakta Mokshanam? So Rakta Sravana should be up to Sashesha Dosha, and rest of Dosha should be treated with Samyak drugs. So what Acharya Shruta has said is that Raktam Sashesha Dosham Tu Kuryadapi Vichakshanaha. That is what he says is that intelligent surgeon, he should not remove the whole the Rakta Dushti. That is, you should make sure that excess blood should not be removed. Rather than that, Sashesha Dosha, some doshas you keep it as it is, which can be pacified or which can be treated by Shaman Aushadhi. So let me conclude my lecture with this. Siravedan is the best line of treatment in managing acute neurological conditions. So you can say sciatica, lumbago. Siravedan has got, that is Vedan Karma particularly, has got very prime importance in pain management. In present scenario, Jalaukauchan is demanding treatment modality in the field of plastic surgery, reconstructive and microsurgery. Earlierly, I says that because the chances of graft rejection are reduced by this Jalaukaucharana. Prachana Karma gives promising results in alopecia-like conditions. And in spite of various these treatment modalities, physician's yukti is at most important in selecting specific raktamokshana in different diseases. As Acharya Charaka has nicely says that yatha dosham yatha balam. And we can say yatha yukti, that is physician's yukti is very much important. We have to assess the doshas, the bal of the patient, and the proper selection of raktamokshana will definitely give a fantastic results in various diseases. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for sharing your wonderful knowledge with the clinical experience. Now this is the time for question and discussion. Ma'am, we have some questions by the audience.
Yeah.
First question, where to do Agni Karma in Krimidanta?
Hello?
My question is, ma'am, where to do Agni Karma in Krimidanta?
In case of Danta, that is teeth disorder, he said that is below tongue will be the good site for doing the Vedana Karma. So Vedana is not only like we have to bleed. So sometimes it is says that very small vessels are there which will bleed inside but will not be visible outside. So for any tongue or a teeth, that is Danta Rogas, he says that you have to go for Vedana Karma below the tongue.
Thank you, ma'am. Hmm. Can you do Shringa Rakta Mokshana in diabetic neuropathy?
Yeah, we can go for diabetic neuropathy. Shringa Rakta Mokshana can be carried out. But we have to see that, as I said earlier, that you have to see the doshas, the bala of a patient, and then we can choose a proper line of a treatment modality.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question. In abscess of eye, where is done can do Siraveda?
Abscess?
Abscess at eyesight, ma'am.
Abscess at eyesight, okay.
Near the eyes.
Okay.
Where to do the Siraveda?
Siraveda. So whenever the eye diseases, abscess, exactly not like, because when we consider the Vidradi, we have to do it in Amavastha, because when it ultimately goes into the Pakvavastha, we have to remove the abscess. So that is also one Vistravan. Vistravan karma, like, it's not only like vein puncturing, so draining anything. So in Amavastha, you can go for a Jalaukavacharan, and in Pakvavastha, you can go for a Vistravana karma. So whenever there is eye diseases are there, and we need a Vistravan karma, so you can go for an Apanga Pradesha. So particularly when you talk about the Vidradi, obviously wherever there is a Vidradi, we have to do at the same site. And if the eye diseases are there, so particularly for eye diseases, he has explained, you have to go for Vyadhana karma at Apanga Pradesha.
Thank you. Another question. Can jaloka can be used in pedatra management?
Jaloka can be used in yavana pedika. Yeah, jaloka can be used in that because ultimately tvaka dushti will be there, so you can go for it because it's a painful condition also. So rakta dushti, any rakta dushti disorders, you can go for a rakta mokshana. So particularly in case of because yavana pedika, for a face, the best option will be a jaloka ucharana.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question. Jaloka ucharana means ashas. Question is jaloka ucharana means ashas.
Hello.
Can I audible, ma'am? Hello.
Hello.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, Vinayak. Hello. Ha, Vinayak, ask question.
Question is jaloka ucharana in arshas.
Jaloka ucharana in arshas. Okay. So whenever there is a like you can say hematoma is there in arshas, you can go for a jaloka ucharana in case of arshas, because again in arshas chaturvidha treatment modalities are explained. So depending upon the conditions, so particularly whenever it is like a hematoma formation is there, at that time you can go for a jaloka ucharana.
Thank you, ma'am. Can jaloka ucharana given a patient having a blood clotting problem?
That is what I said in my presentation. Before that, you have to look for a like what are the different diseases of a patient. Routine blood is to be carried out. So if the patient gives the history of a deficiency of a clotting factor, it's better to be avoided because it will be very difficult to stop the blood. That is what it's better to be avoided. Because again, if you see the saliva of a leech, it has got many anticoagulant enzymes. So it's better not to be done in such a patients. It is a contraindicated.
Next question is site for saravada in acute pain management.
See, what Acharya says is that because he has not explained for each and every diseases exactly where the jaloka ucharan or any rakta mokshan is to be performed. So whenever there is a pain, we can say is that it's a vikruta shula. And vikruta shula, obviously it is going to do a marga varodhana. So whenever we do a vyadhana karma at the same site, obviously the pain will get reduced. So whenever the site exactly is not explained for a particular whenever the shoe, wherever the shul is present at the same site, you can go for a vedana karma. So this vedana karma has got a fantastic results in a pain management.
Okay, next question. What is the age criteria for the patient for the selection for the jaloka ucharana?
Jaloka ucharana. So jaloka ucharana indication is like that. It is used in case of a children's, etc. So there is no age limit. You can use the jaloka as it is a safer site at any age.
Okay. Please explain the mode of action of prachana karma in alopecia.
prachana karma in alopecia. Okay. So in Indralupta, obviously, it is the rakta pradhana vyadhi. So ultimately, it is because uthana rakta avastha will be there, and in uthana rakta avastha, it will remove the rakta vritta, whatever it is, and it will get cure. So uthana rakta avastha is the indication for prachana karma. So rakta dushti is present in that case, we can go for a prachana karma.
Next question. Scar management in prachana karma.
So the scar management, the scar is going to heal by itself, no need, because we are not going too deeper for a scar. So at minimum 2 mm, like it's a 2 mm the scar what we are making is. So you can, this scar can be managed by applying the Shatadhauta Ghruta etc. after this prachana karma. So it's a very small, if you leave by itself also the scar will heal, because this will be a very minimal scars. So you can go for a Shatadhauta Ghruta also. You can apply it for the wound healing.
Thank you. Another question. Ma'am, can you explain the Samyak Lakshana of Peptin therapy?
Hello?
Samyak Lakshana of Peptin therapy.
Samyak Lakshana of?
Peptin therapy.
Cupping therapy. Here the cupping therapy is nothing but a modernized one. And what Acharya Shushruta has explained, the Samyak Lakshana for Rakta Mokshan, the same can be applied there. It's not like that. We are not. So whatever he has said, the Samyak Lakshana, like after a Muhurta, the stoppage of blood, like that is one. Laghuta will be there. So these Samyak Lakshana, we can say in that can be applied, whatever the Samyak Lakshana is applied for other Rakta Mokshanas, the same can be applied for cupping therapy also. So Laghota will be there, blood will stop by itself, whatever the pain is there, that pain is get reduced. So this Samyak Lakshana can be applied for cupping also.
Another question. Whether we can use REACH more than one time, and if you used after the, how many days it can be used for that?
About leech, we are using the gap of a 7 days. If the same leech is performed for another person, that leech can be used for after 7 days. The same research we are started in our institute, that whether why exactly 7 days or why exactly 15 days or how many days gap can be kept for a leech. So we took that is the saliva of the leech to see whether what kind of bacteria it will carry or what kind of infection it will carry from one person to the another person. But still the research is going on. But we practically what we are doing is we are applying the leech after 7 days, by the gap of a 7 days to a patient. Like one leech, it can be again reused after 7 days for another patient. So that is what it is contraindicated in HIV patients and all, because if that leech is used for a HIV patient, because we don't know whether it is carrying virus and all, still need research is to be done. And the same thing we are carrying in our institute.
Another question. Some indications where all prachana is to be done.
Pardon?
Some indication where all prachana is to be done.
Indications?
I mean, they are asking the prachana karma indications.
Prachana karma indications. Okay. So yes, I yes. Already said wherever there is a uthana rakta avastha, you can go for a prachana karma. So particularly in skin diseases, practically we can do a prachana karma. For example, like a status dermatitis will be there. Any kind of eczemas or alopecia like conditions. So whenever there is a uthana rakta avastha, you can go for a prachana karma. So practically it has gave very good results in case of status dermatitis or any skin diseases. You can go like visarpa, etc. So it has got good result in skin disorders.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question, Jaloka Ucharna can be given in Ratapitta disorder.
Jalavaka Ucharan? Yeah, Jalavaka Ucharan is indicated for Pittaj disorders. So obviously it is a Rakta Dushti. If it is present, you can go for a Jalavaka Ucharan, no issue. So like how the Shrunga is explained for Vataj, Jalavaka is explained for Pittaj, and Alabu is indicated for Kapha's disorders.
Thank you, ma'am. Another question, how to assess the patient? If it is in a window period of HIV, we have to Jalavaka Ucharan.
That is very difficult question. That is practically, we need to do a research on that. It's very difficult if the patient, because we are performing surgery also, we are not, will not be knowing. So obviously, we need to take a precautions while doing Jalavaka Ucharan. And I think after 7 days, because whatever we saw the result till now of our research, it is not carrying any bacteria or the viruses through leeches. And if you see the HIV patients, so obviously you know that whenever it comes out, immediately the virus will get dead when it exposes to the environment. And we are carrying the vomiting of Jalavaka Ucharan, but still it is a question whether it carries the HIV virus. So in window period, it's a doubt, because if a known case of patient of HIV is there, we are not doing a Jalavaka Ucharan. Or if needed, we do a Jalavaka Ucharan also, we have not used that Jalavaka for another patient. So window period, it's very difficult for everyone, I think.
Thank you, ma'am. Last question on this session.
Yeah.
How the leech will get to Shodhanam, ma'am, after 7 days?
How leech is?
How leech will get Shodhanam after the 7 days?
How leech is going to?
Ma'am, because we are giving 7 days gap for the end.
Gap, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Asking how it will get Shodhana by itself within 7 days.
Shodhana by itself. So what we do is after Jalavaka Ucharan, we vomit, we carry the vomiting of Jalavaka Ucharan. So obviously the whatever the suck blood is there, that will get vomited immediately after the Jalavaka Ucharan. So the same thing I'm going to repeat again, because it's a need of a research, and the research is carrying on in our institute. We need to wait for a further details because so far, whatever the research we have done, it is not going to carry any bacteria. So ultimately, it is not going to carry any bacteria or from the patient's body whenever it is applied earlier. So that can be considered.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much for sharing your knowledge. Before starting the next session, we need some words from your side, ma'am.
I'd like to thank the management committee of Gramin Terdar Ayurveda College. I thank to the principal, sir, Dr. Biradar. I thank the organizing secretary, Dr. Tas, sir, and the coordinator, Dr. Vinayak, for giving me an opportunity to share my knowledge on a view of national webinar. Thank you very much. It's a really wonderful concept what you people are dealing with. Thank you so much for giving an opportunity to share my knowledge. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let's start the second session. Next speaker is Dr. Supra Sharma. I'll call Rupulu ma'am to introduce Dr. Supra Sharma.
Good morning to all. On this recent occasion, I would like to introduce Dr. Sukran Sharma sir. Dr. Sukran Sharma sir, born on 18 February 1987, sir has completed BNS degree from Dayananda Ayurvedic Medical College, Jalandhar, and completed MS in Shalya Tantra from SVM Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya and College, Udupi. Currently working as assistant professor in PG Department of Shalyatantra, Jammu, Institute of Ayurveda and Research. And sir is co-guiding many students in their dissertation and has published many papers on clinical and experimental studies in national and international journals, and has been invited as a resource person to various CMEs and SENNA. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for the introduction speech. Sir is on. Sir, I will share slides. Wait for 5 minutes, sir. Sukran sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes, Vinayak, thank you so much. Am I audible?
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
A very good afternoon to all of you. So the topic which I am going to take today is the taking the ancient road to the inguinal hernia with special emphasis in COVID-19 era. Next slide, please. So to begin with, I want to pay obedience to Sri Lord Manjunatheshwara and to my teachers, Dr. K.R. Ramchandra, my former HOD, and my guide, Dr. Muralidhar Sharma, sir. Without their guidance, I would not have been able to what I am today. Thank you. Next slide. So, okay, to going towards the hernia, as most of all of you will be knowing what basically is hernia. So just a quick revision of what is hernia. So hernia is basically an abnormal protrusion in a part or whole of the viscous through an abnormal opening in the wall of the cavity which contains it. As you can see in the photograph on your screen, as the intestines are contained in the wall which is lined by the abdominal musculature and the peritoneum. So if because of any reason, if there is any weakness or an abnormal opening in the wall which contains the intestinal intestines, and there is protrusion of either whole of the intestine or its part or maybe omentum or some other contents through this abnormal opening, it is termed as the hernia. So hernias are basically classified variously, but most common classification is based upon the site from where the hernia is occurring. So the inguinal hernia accounts the most of the cases, up to 75%, followed by the femoral hernia, which accounts 17%, umbilical hernia 8.5%. There are certain rare types of hernia which are rarely seen in the clinical practice, which includes epigastric hernia, lumbar hernia, and obturator hernia. Next slide. So going to the etiology, the etiology of hernias can be categorized into two. First is if it is caused because of the weakness of the abdominal musculature, or second, if it is caused due to the increase in the intra-abdominal pressure. If it is caused due to the weakness of the abdominal musculature, it can further be subdivided into two types, either because of the congenital weakness, as it is seen in the cases of those males where there is persistence of the processus vaginalis. Processus vaginalis is a layer of the peritoneum which comes along with the testis during its descent. So if it does not fuse, this processus vaginalis fails to fuse, it leads to formation of a preformed sac, which give rise to congenital type of the inguinal hernia. In females also, it may give rise to a kind of congenital inguinal hernia. And another example is in the case of the congenital umbilical hernia, where the umbilicus scar fails to obliterate, giving rise to the congenital type of the umbilical hernia. Second is the acquired weakness. It can be because of the many reasons. The first and foremost is the obesity. In an obese patient, what the common understanding should say that they have a lot of fat on their abdomen, so they should not get the weakness in the abdominal musculature. But this is not a true understanding. As the fat deposits on the abdominal muscle, the fat molecules or the fat lobules separates the fibers of the muscles. Because of the pressure, it leads to the atrophy of the muscles, and also the fibers get separated because of the deposition of the fat, which ultimately leads to the weakness of the abdominal musculature, and it causes the various types of the hernias, which can be either inguinal hernia, it can be a paraumbilical hernia, or even it may cause a hiatus hernia. Next is the weakness which may be caused because of the repeated pregnancy. As you all are aware, if there are multiple pregnancies, 3-4 pregnancies, and every time the gravid uterus enlarges, it may lead to the weakness of the muscles. And another reason for the acquired weakness is the surgical incision. There are certain type of the surgical incision which may lead to the incisional hernias later on, or may lead to the recurrent hernias. The most common being the surgical incision for the appendectomy. If it cuts through the ilioinguinal nerve, it will lead to the muscles weakness of the muscles of the abdomen, which may in future cause a direct kind type of the inguinal hernia. Also, the incisional hernia develops through the weakened abdominal muscles following the previous operations. So most of the infections in the early postoperative period or excessive fat in the abdominal wall predisposes the incisional hernia. Going to the second etiological causes, these are the increased intra-abdominal pressure. I would like to drive your special attention towards these causes, as when we will be discussing the Ayurvedic portion of the hernia, we can see the beauty by which the Sushruta's etiologies correlate to the following to the present day. So the increased intra-abdominal pressure may be caused because of the whooping cough in the children's, chronic cough in the tuberculosis patient or bronchitis patients, bladder neck obstruction, which causes the patient's urine obstruction and the patient has to strain for passing of the urine, BPH, benign prostate hypertrophy, straining during the weightlifting, and constipation, and the repeated pregnancies may lead to the increased intra-abdominal pressure, which may later on cause the inguinal hernia or various kind of other hernias. Next. So going to the pathology, a hernia basically consists of the three parts. As you can see in the photograph, it consists of the sac, the contents of the sacs, and the coverings of the sac. So sac is basically a pouch of the peritoneum, which comes out through the abdominal musculature. This sac contains the abdominal viscus, which are called as the contents of the sac, and it has covering which starts from the skin to the sac itself. So all the coverings which lie between the skin and to the sac, which may include the skin, the campus fascia, scarpa fascia, external oblique aponeurosis, and the coverings of the sac, they form the sac. And then this sac can be divided into four parts. First is the mouth, that is the opening of the sac through which the contents enter the sac. It is called as the mouth. Second is the neck. Neck is the most constricted part of the sac, which passes through the abdominal musculature. Body of the sac, which is the main portion of the sac. And then last is the fundus of the sac, which is the most redundant part of the sac. The contents of the sac are basically the abdominal viscus, which are contained inside the sac. Depending upon the content, the contents are classified as omentocele if the content is omentum, enterocele if the content is intestine. The content may also be a portion of the bladder, or sometimes it is present in the direct inguinal or it's sliding inguinal hernia. Ovary may also be the contents without the fallopian tube. The contents may be a Meckel's diverticulum when it is called as the Littes hernia. The content may also be a portion of the circumference of the intestine when it is called as the two lobes of the small intestine, the manner of a W, it is called as the Meidel's hernia. The covering of the sac, as I've already told, all the coverings from the skin to the sac, the muscles which follows in between these are the coverings of the sac. Next slide. So the classification, every hernia can be classified according to this classification. It may be a reducible hernia, which is one of the two most characteristic features of the hernia. A hernia is said to be reducible when patient if lies down, the hernia reduces itself. That means it goes back into the cavity from where it is protruding, or it is reduced by the surgeon itself. It is one of the second most important characteristic feature of the hernia, followed by the cuff impulse. Second is the irreducible hernia. Irreducible hernia is that hernia when the contents of the hernia cannot be returned back. to the abdomen, it is called as an irreducible hernia. Adhesions are the major cause for this irreducibility. These adhesions may be between the contents to each other, adhesion of the its content with the sac. That means if the contents, that is either the intestine or the omentum, gets adhered to the sac, it causes irreducibility. Adhesions of the one part of the sac to the other part, that means the sac in itself gets adhered to its two sides, which leads to the failure of the contents to go back into the cavity from where it is protruding. Presence of the omentum in the sac often causes the irreducibility. The reducibility, when we are trying to reduce the sac, the omentum first part get easily inside to the cavity, but the redundant part is difficult to reduce. So omentum may cause irreducibility, or when the content is large intestine, which becomes obstructed, then also it leads to the irreducible kind of hernia. Or if there is a massive hernia which has reached the scrotal, it is called as the scrotal hernia, then also it becomes irreducible. Next is the obstructive or incarcerated hernia. So if the hernia is associated with irreducibility and the intestinal obstruction, that means the lumen of the bowel or the intestine is loaded with the feces and the contents cannot move from proximal to distal part, it is called as the intestinal obstruction. So when a hernia is accompanied with the irreducibility and the intestinal obstruction, it is called as the obstructed hernia. The classical features of this obstructed hernia is that the expansile cuff impulse is not present, the hernia is irreducible, the patient does not complain of the pain. This has to be noted that in this obstructed type of hernia, the patient will not complain of the pain, and the hernia is lax and non-tender. And along with these features, there will be the features of the intestinal obstruction. Next is the strangulated hernia. This requires immediate attention and emergency surgery. So the strangulated hernia is basically hernia in which there is obstruction. That means there is irreducibility, there is intestinal obstruction, and along with that, there is arrest of the blood supply to the contents. As the blood supply of the contents is compromised, it will lead to the gangrene, and which may ultimately lead to the perforation. The clinical presentation of such patient is that the patient first complains of the pain and vomiting, and pain is particularly located to the hernial site. In the case of internal strangulation, it is located at the umbilicus. Initially, as the pain is located at the hernial site, but later on, this pain spreads all through over the abdomen, and the vomiting, which was first complained along with the pain, it becomes forcible and frequent. If the strangulation is not relieved, the paroxysm of pain continues. But as the gangrene sets in, and if it is a perforation, the pain will diminish. So this can be sometimes misleading if a clinician does not take into account that whether gangrene has set and the pain is relieved because of this gangrene. Then it may be dangerous for the patient and will compromise the outcome. Next is the inflamed hernia, in which the hernial inflammation can occur from the outside by an ill-fitting truss, or from the inside if the content is either an inflamed fallopian tube or appendix. The difference between inflamed hernia and strangulated hernia is that this inflamed hernia does not present with the clinical symptoms of the intestinal obstruction, and it is not as tense as like a strangulated hernia. Next slide. So coming to the first, to understand the inguinal hernia, it is important that we revise the anatomy of the inguinal canal. So inguinal canal is basically, as you can see in the photographs, it is basically a triangular slit which is almost horizontal in the direction. It lies from the mid inguinal region, that is, this inguinal hernia anatomy, this begins within the mid inguinal point, that is 1.5 inch above the line joining the anterior superior iliac spine to the pubic tubercle. The inguinal hernia usually occurs from the deep ring, which is a defect in the fascia transversalis, and the deep ring, which is an opening in the fascia transversalis 1.25 centimeter above the mid inguinal point. It is of an oval shape and the long axes are vertical. Medially, this deep ring is related to the inferior epigastric vessels, as you can see in the photograph. Then the superficial ring, which is an interval in the aponeurosis of the external oblique muscle. It is located just above and lateral to the crest of the pubis. Next slide. Now the boundaries of the inguinal canal, usually there are the four boundaries. The anatomy defines the four boundaries of the inguinal canal: anterior boundary, posterior boundary, boundary above the inguinal canal, and boundary below the inguinal canal. Anteriorly, through the whole length of the inguinal canal, it is covered by the skin, superficial fascia, and the aponeurosis of the external oblique. And in its lateral one third, there is the fleshy fibers of the origin of the internal oblique. Posteriorly, which is important to understand, the posterior wall of the inguinal canal is formed by the transversalis fascia along the whole length of the canal, and it is separated from the extraperitoneal cavity connective tissue through the peritoneum. In the middle half, there is the conjoint tendon and the reflected part of the inguinal ligament. Above, there are the arch fibers of the internal oblique and the transversus abdominis muscle, and below, that it is formed by the groove surface of the inguinal ligament along with its union to the fascia transversalis. At the medial end, there is lacunar ligament. Next. So inguinal hernia is basically classified as indirect and the direct inguinal hernia. Inguinal hernia is basically protrusion of a part of the contents of the abdomen through the inguinal region of the abdominal wall. As we have seen in the previous slide, inguinal region is a weak part of the abdominal wall due to the presence of the inguinal canal, deep inguinal ring, and the superficial inguinal ring. These are the portions through which the contents of the abdomen can protrude out. So it is divided into, it is classified into two: indirect hernia and the direct inguinal hernia. An indirect inguinal hernia, the contents of the abdomen enter through the deep inguinal ring and transverse the whole length of the inguinal canal to come out through the superficial inguinal ring. Whereas in the case of a direct inguinal hernia, the hernial contents protrude through the posterior wall of the inguinal canal medial to the inferior epigastric vessels, that is the Hazelbeck's triangle. Hazelbeck's triangle is formed by the boundaries of the outer border of the rectus abdominis muscle medially. Laterally, it is marked by the inferior epigastric vessels, and below by the medial part of the inguinal ligament. The indirect hernia is also, depending upon the extent of hernia, it is divided into three groups, that is the bubinocele, funicular hernia, and the complete vaginal or the scrotal hernia. Bubinocele is that kind of indirect inguinal hernia where the hernia is limited in the inguinal canal and the processus vaginalis is closed at the superficial inguinal ring. This is basically due to the failure of the processus vaginalis to fuse at the deep inguinal ring. The processus vaginalis fuses at three places. First is the at the deep inguinal ring. Second, it fuses just above the testis. And third, between the deep inguinal ring and the superficial inguinal ring. So if there is failure of fusion of this processus vaginalis at the deep inguinal ring, it will lead to the hernia coming into the inguinal canal but not descending forward. This is called as a bubinocele. Second is the funicular hernia. Here the processus vaginalis is closed at the lower end, just above the epididymis. So the contents of the hernia can be felt separately from the testis, and testis lies below the hernia. Most of these hernias occur in the adults, and there is a long-standing history which is usually received in these cases. Third is the complete or vaginal or scrotal hernia. Here the processus vaginalis is patent throughout the length of the inguinal canal to the scrotum or the testis. So the hernia sac continues with the tunica vaginalis of the testis. And in these cases, the hernia descend down to the bottom of the scrotum, lying in the front and at the site of the testis. As in the case of the funicular hernia, the testis can be felt separately from the hernial sac. But here the testis cannot be felt separately from the anterior side or from the side. It can be only felt separate from the contents from the posterior surface of the hernial sac with very great difficulty. And in the case of the direct hernia, it presents as a bulge in the at the superficial ring. The direct hernia is usually mostly acquired type, whereas the indirect hernias are mostly congenital type. In the indirect hernia, the patient are usually the young children, infants, or maybe young adults. Whereas in the case of the direct inguinal hernia, which is usually acquired, the patients are in the elderly, with an exception of being an ogive hernia, in which there is a congenital small rigid circular orifice in the conjoint tendon just lateral to where it inserts with the rectus sheath. Next slide, please. So coming on to the clinical features, as we have discussed in the history, the indirect hernias are seen mostly in the children and young adults, whereas the direct hernia are kind of acquired hernia, which are seen in the older age. Going to the history of the occupation, the strenuous work is most often responsible for the development of the hernia. Heavy work, especially lifting weights, puts great strain on the abdominal muscle and causes the increased intra-abdominal pressure. And if there is an underlying weakness already present, hernia may develop. The patient may be able to correlate the onset of the hernia to a particular event. The patient will say that first he noticed the hernia when he was lifting some kind of a heavy weight. So symptoms, the pain is the commonest symptom of the hernia, which is described as a kind of discomfort. The nature of the pain is that it is kind of a dragging or aching type of pain in the groin, which worsens as the day passes, because the patient is working whole day and under the effect of the gravity, and if he is doing some strenuous activities, that defect may increase or the contents may get more and more traveling into the inguinal canal. So as the day progresses, the patient complains of the dragging or the aching kind of pain. Also, the pain may appear long before the onset of the lump is noticed. The patient will say that I was having a pain before, but the lump or the swelling has occurred quite late. And pain continues so long as the hernia progresses, but ceases when it is fully formed. In a well-formed hernia, there is a sense of heaviness or the weight. Also, as the hernia is protruding into the inguinal canal, there will be a pull on the mesentery, which may cause the pain in the epigastric region. And the pain may be complained of all over the abdomen due to the drag on the mesentery or on the omentum. Next is the lump. Many hernia causes no pain, and the patient will complain only as will come to a clinician only with the complaint of a lump in the groin. Systemic symptoms can also be noticed with these hernias, especially if they are obstructed hernias. So the patient may complain of a bulky abdominal pain, vomiting, abdominal distension, and absolute constipation if it is complete intestinal obstruction. Also, the vomitus character should be noted, whether it is a bilious or fecal. Fecal smelling vomitus is a ominous sign, as it may indicate a perforation. Other complaints can also be associated with these hernias. As we have discussed earlier, history of a chronic whooping cough or chronic bronchitis, constipation, dysuria, which may be due to the BPH, or a stricture urethra, which may cause a bladder outlet obstruction. So sometimes leading questions should be asked to the patient if a clinician suspect, from the age of the patient, if patient is above 60 years, so history of BPH should be excluded, or history of a tuberculosis, or if a patient is smoker, the history of chronic bronchitis should be ruled out. Last is the past history. So if the patient has any operation or not, that should be asked, because as we have seen in the earlier slide, appendectomy can lead to direct hernia if the ilioinguinal nerve is divided or subcostal nerve is divided, which may lead to the weakness of the abdominal muscles at the inguinal region. It will basically give rise to the direct inguinal hernia. It won't cause indirect inguinal hernia, but a direct inguinal hernia may be caused because of the weakness of the abdominal musculatures. Next slide, please. So local examination. Against the common belief that the patient should be examined in a supine position, hernias are best visualized or best examined in the standing position, even though it should be examined in the supine position also. So to examine this patient, the position and the extent of the hernia should be noted. If the swelling descends into the scrotum or to the labia majora, it is obviously an inguinal hernia. It can be confirmed if it is just confined to the groin. It should be differentiated from the femoral hernia. In this, two anatomical structures will come to your aid. First is the pubic tubercle and second is the inguinal ligament. If it is a case of the inguinal hernia, it will be positioned above the inguinal ligament and medial to the pubic tubercle. I repeat, if it is an inguinal hernia, it will be positioned above the inguinal ligament and medial to the pubic tubercle. Whereas if it is a femoral hernia, it will lie below the inguinal ligament and lateral to the pubic tubercle, as this femoral ring is situated at this position. Second is to get above the swelling. This is an important clinical sign to differentiate an inguinal scrotal swelling from a completely scrotal swelling. In this examination, the root of the scrotum is held between the thumb in the front and the other fingers behind, and an attempt is made to reach above the swelling. If it is a case of the inguinal hernia which has descended into the scrotum, one cannot get above the swelling. That means there will be the hernial sac between the thumb and the fingers. Whereas if it is a case of a hydrocele or a purely scrotal swelling, the two fingers can be joined together. So this is called as to get above the swelling. Next is the consistency. So if the inguinal hernia contains the omentum, that means if it is an omentocele or epiplocele, The swelling feels doughy or granular. Doughy means kind of the wheat which has been doughed off. And if it is a case of a intestine, that is the enterocele, it feels like a elastic, just like the characteristic of the intestine. A strangulated hernia feels tense and tender, whereas an obstructed hernia will have indentation. If a finger is indented on this, there will be a putty like indentation over this because of the feces which are impacted inside the intestine. Next is the impulse on cuffing. So if there is no swelling, if a finger is placed on the superficial inguinal ring and after the patient cuffs, that shows there is no impulse on cuffing. But if the root of the scrotum is held between the index finger and thumb and the patient is asked to cuff, an expansile cuff impulse can be felt on cuffing as the contents of the hernia will be forced out through the superficial inguinal ring and it will separate the thumb from the index finger. Next is the reducibility. So in this, as we have seen earlier, the patient is asked to lie down on the bed. If it is a spontaneously reducible hernia, the hernia will go back and reduce. But if it is a non-spontaneous kind of the inguinal hernia, the clinician needs to try to reduce this. This is done by asking the patient to adduct the affected side of the thigh and to rotate it internally. This will relax the pillars of the superficial ring, but also the oblique muscles of the abdomen. So here the fundus of the sac is gently held with one hand and an even pressure is applied. Gentle pressure is applied to squeeze the contents into the abdomen, while the other hand will guide the contents through the superficial inguinal ring. I repeat, in this, the patient is asked to lie down and then he is told to flex the thigh of the affected side to adduct and rotate internally. After this, the fundus of the sac is gently held with one hand and it is gently tried to push it inside to the abdominal cavity through the superficial inguinal ring. This process is known as the taxis. Next is the invagination test. So here, after the reduction of the hernia, this test is performed most of the time on table. Once the patient is lied on the OT table, this test is performed. Here the little finger is used and it is invaginated to the skin from the bottom of the scrotum. Then the little finger is gradually pushed up and then rotated inside to enter the superficial inguinal ring. Once the ring, the pulp of the index finger is inside the superficial inguinal ring, the patient is asked to cuff. If the impulse is felt on the pulp of the finger, then it is a case of a direct inguinal hernia. But if it is felt on the tip of the finger, that means it is descending from the above, from the deep inguinal ring and is passing through the superficial ring, it will hit on to the tip of the finger. So that is a case of the indirect inguinal hernia. And then last is the ring occlusion test. In this, the hernia must be reduced first. A thumb is pressed on the deep inguinal ring, that is 1.5 inches above the mid inguinal point, and the patient is asked to cuff. If it is a case of the indirect hernia, the ring occlusion test, there will be no swelling will be visible. But if it is a case of a direct hernia, it will show a mild bulge medial to the occluding finger. That means as the finger is on the deep inguinal ring, the superficial inguinal ring is free. So if the hernia is coming from the superficial inguinal ring, that will be visible when the patient cuffs. That is an expansile cuff impulse. But if the hernia is occurring from the deep inguinal ring, at that time, if the occluding finger is on the deep inguinal ring, the hernia will not be seen coming out. It is important to note that this ring occlusion test should be done after the reduction, because if you perform this ring occlusion test without doing the taxis and reducing the hernia, it will be a misleading test. Next slide. So coming to the treatment of the inguinal hernia, operation or surgery is undoubtedly the treatment of choice of the inguinal hernia. That should always be noted. If a person is fit for the hernia, fit for the anesthesia, and if there is no contraindication of the anesthesia, which is rarely due to the presence of the modern advances in anesthetic techniques, surgery is undoubtedly the treatment of choice of the inguinal hernia, as a hernia, inguinal hernia, can always lead to strangulation or obstruction. But still, conservative treatment is defined. When to follow this? No treatment should be performed if the patient is with a severe general health. That means the health of the patient does not permit any kind of the treatment. At that time, the treatment should not be given, or with a short life expectancy, or in those patients who refuse the operation, no treatment should be done. Or truss, which is a kind of the belt which is tied to the site of the hernia in an attempt allow it to protrude out. So this truss basically does not cure the hernia. Exception is of the newborns, where for the 2 years, if the hernia is not allowed to protrude through the hernial orifice because of the fibrosis, the hernia may cure in the case of the newborns, especially in the kind of the umbilical hernia. This is practiced. But this stress has its own dangers, like it may cause adhesions, obstruction, and even the strangulation. And also, for allowing truss to be used, a patient should be intelligent enough and the hernia should be reducible. This truss cannot be tried in the case of the obstructed hernia or even in the case of the irreducible hernia. This truss should not be tried. Next slide. So operative treatment, I won't be going into the steps of the surgery. If anyone has doubt, he or she can ask in the end of the presentation. So basically, there are three principles of the surgery of the hernia. This applies to all kind of hernia, but we'll be discussing especially in the case of the inguinal hernia. So first is the herniotomy. Herniotomy, as the name defines, otomy means just the opening of the sac. So here, in the herniotomy, after the incision is made 1 inch above and parallel to the medial 2/3 of the inguinal ligament, the hernial sac is identified, the hernial sac is opened and inspected. If the contents are there, they are reduced back, and after that the transfixed ligation of the sac at the neck is performed, followed by the excision of the sac. In this, there is no repair of the inguinal canal, or the posterior surface of the inguinal canal is performed. That means it is just the excision of the redundant part of the hernial sac. Usually this type of surgery is performed in the children or the young adults with a very good muscular tone, especially in the kind of the indirect hernia. This herniotomy is sufficient for the treatment. Next is the herniorrhaphy. In this, after performing the herniotomy, the repair of the posterior wall is performed using non-absorbable sutures. Usually two common techniques are used for this herniorrhaphy. One is the Bassinis repair, where the posterior wall is strengthened by stitching the lower margins of the muscles of the internal oblique muscle and transverse abdominis and the conjoint tendon to the inner margin of the inguinal ligament. That means the upper groove surface of the internal oblique and the transverse abdominis are sutured along with the conjoint tendon on one side to the inner margin of the inguinal ligament behind the spermatic cord. Usually 3 to 5 interrupted non-absorbable sutures are applied. And the other is the Scholtes technique. Scholtes technique is in that the transversalis fascia is incised from the deep inguinal ring to the most medial part as far as possible. And after that, the double breasting of this transversalis fascia is done and the posterior wall is repaired just like the Bassinis repair, where the conjoint tendon is sutured to the inner margin of the inguinal ligament. This herniorrhaphy is also best suited for the indirect kind of the inguinal hernias. Hernioplasty is a procedure where the herniotomy is done, and after that, reinforced repair of the posterior wall is done using autogenous or heterogeneous material. This autogenous material are the strip of the autogenous means direct of the materials obtained directly from the patient himself. So it can be a strip of the facial ata from the lateral side of the thigh. It can be a strip of the external oblique or pneurosis. It can be a flap of the anterior rectus sheath, or it can be a skin flap. So autogenous material includes the muscles or the fascia obtained from the patient himself or herself, or it may be a heterogeneous material, which may include a polypropylene mesh or a stainless steel mesh. The indications of hernioplasty is all cases of the indirect hernia in which the patient has a poor muscular tone, where the surgeon feels that even after performing the hernioplasty, the muscles are weakly sufficient that there may be chance of the recurrence. All the cases of the direct hernia also needs hernioplasty, that is the defect in the Hasselbeck's triangle or the superficial inguinal ring needs to be closed using the mesh or the facial layers. All the cases of the recurrent hernia, those hernia which have initially been treated by the herniorrhaphy and they come again, in that cases the heterogeneous material is mostly widely practiced today, that is the polypropylene mesh. And all those patients who do strenuous job or suffer from the chronic bronchitis or enlarged prostate, that means the high risk patients, those who are at high risk of developing recurrence, in those cases this polypropylene mesh is used. Next slide. So as we have seen in the previous slide, that the contemporary science has a very beautiful understanding of the hernia and the treatment is also widely successful. So now the question is, why do we need Ayurveda or why do we need Ayurvedic interventions for this? The answer is the COVID times, that we are presently in the COVID 19 era, and there are definitely certain contraindications, or the emergency surgeries are only practiced these days, and the elective surgeries are usually deferred. So that is why in the meantime we need to try the Ayurveda. So that is why Ayurveda holds the key to these times. Next slide. Next slide, please. So these are the certain guidelines, especially in the COVID-19 era and along for the surgeries. So as you can see, ACS, American College of the Surgeons, recommends that the elective surgery should be curtailed. That means they should be deferred for a later days. And also, it is advised these days to consider the non-operative management whenever it is clinically appropriate for the patient. That means the conservative approaches or non-surgical approaches should be utilized these days to decrease the load of the surgery and the decrease load on the hospital resources. Next slide. Also, this is a guideline from the Royal College of Surgeons. They also consider non-operative management whenever it is clinically appropriate for the patient. And also, patient presenting with a suspected bowel perforation, intestinal ischemia, closed loop obstruction, obstruction secondary to the incarcerated, that is an obstructed hernia, should proceed with the emergent surgeries. Otherwise, non-operative management of the small bowel should be done. Next slide. Also, our Acharya has mentioned in Sushrut Samhita that Dvivid Vyadhya, Shastra Sadhya, Snehadi Kriya Sadhyascha, Tatra Shastra Sadheshu, Snehadi Kriya Na Pratishidhyate, Snehadi Kriya Sadheshu, Shastra Karam Na Kriyate. In Vyadhi Samudeshi Adhyaya, Acharya Sushruta quote this shlok. That means there are two types of the disorders. One is the surgical disorder, and another are the conservative or the medically managed disorders. Even if it is a surgical disorder, there is a clear-cut guidance from the Acharya Sushruta that Snehadi Kriya, that is the conservative approaches, are not contraindicated for a purely surgical case also. But for a non-surgical cases, surgery should not be performed. So going by these lines, next slide. Now we'll try to understand Antravriddhi in terms of Ayurveda, or what Acharya Sushruta has to say about this. So Antravriddhi has been explained in Sushrut Nidan, 12th chapter, that is the Vriddhi Uplanch Sleepal Nidan. Here Acharya Sushruta quotes that Vat Vitta Shleshma Shonit Medo Mutra Antra Nimittaha Sapta Vriddhya Tasa Mutra Antra Nimitta Vriddhi Vat Samuthe Kevalam Utpattir Hetu Anyatama. That means the Vriddhi or the scrotal swellings or the scrotal enlargements are of seven types, which may be Vataj, Pittaj, Kafaj, Raktaj, Medoj, Mutraj and Antraj. Other than the Vataj, Pittaj, Shleshmaj, this Mutra and Antra Vriddhi is caused because of the Vayu, and other than Vayu, here Mutra and Antra are vitiated. That is why these are separately explained. Next slide. So this is the Samanya Samprapti. So Vata Pitta Shleshma Shonit Medo Mutra Antra Nimata Sapta Vridhya. This is the repetition. Sorry. Next slide. अध प्रकुपितो अन्यतमो हि दोषः फल कोश वाहिनीर अपि प्रपद्य धमनी फल कोशयोर वृद्धि जन्यति ताम वृद्धिम इत्यचक्षते. That means dosha when get vitiated, they move downwards to the फल कोश through the फल कोश वाहिनी धमनी. And then he says फल कोशयोर वृद्धि, this means फल कोशो, it is a plural. That means these doshas can go either to the one side of the scrotum, or it may involve the both side of the scrotum and may lead to वृद्धि in that scrotal region. Next slide. Next slide, please. So here Acharya Sushruta explains Antravriddhi along with its hetus in detail. Bhar harnam balvad vigraha vriksh prapatan adi bhir ayas visheshir vayur ati pravriddhi. That means because of the heavy lifting of the weight, balvad vigraha, fighting with a person who is physically more strong than you, Vriksh prapatan, that is falling from a height, or adhir ayas visheshes, means efforts like this, or the reasons like this that has been described earlier. The vayu gets prakupita. Prakupitascha sthul antrasya ek desham vigunam adayo adhogatva vanshan sandhim upetya granthi rupen sthitva apratikriya mane. That means vayu, after getting vitiated, विशेष दी स्थूल अंतरस्य एकदेशम एट वन प्लेस इट विशेष दी स्थूल अंतरस्य एकदेशम विगुणम आदियो अध्यवत गत्वा एंड इट मूव्स और इट पुशेस दी स्थूल अंतर और दी शुद्र अंतर टू दी बिलो एंड इनिशियली इट कम्स एट दी वंक्षण संधि इनग्वाइनल रीजन एंड टेक्स प्लेस ऑफ टेक्स फॉर्म ऑफ दी ग्रंथि ग्रंथि रूपेण स्थित्वा अप्रतिक्रिया माने च कालांतरेण फल कोशम प्रविश्यम मुषक शोफम अपादयति दैट मींस इफ इट इज नॉट ट्रीटेड एट दिस टाइम व्हेन इट इज लोकलाइज्ड एट दी इनग्वाइनल रीजन इट मूव्स डाउन टू दी फल कोश दैट इज इट प्रोग्रेसेस फ्रॉम अ ब्यूबिनोसील व्हिच वी हैव सीन अर्लियर इफ दी स्वेलिंग इज जस्ट एट दी इनग्वाइनल कनाल इट इज कॉल्ड एज अ ब्यूबिनोसील बट इफ इट इज नॉट ट्रीटेड एट दैट टाइम इट मे कंटिन्यू टू फॉर्म अ कंप्लीट स्क्रोटल हर्निया सो इट मूव्स टू दी फलकोशम प्रविश्यम मुषक शोफम अपादयति दैट मींस इट गिव्स राइज टू स्वेलिंग इन दी फलकोशम आदमातो बस्ति ई वातातम प्रदीर दैट मींस इट डिस्टेंड्स जस्ट लाइक अ ब्लैडर फिल्ड विद दी एयर शोफो भवति स शब्दम अपीडश्च ऊर्ध्वम उपेति दिस इज वेरी ब्यूटीफुल एक्सप्लेनेशन ऑफ दी क्लिनिकल साइन एलिसिटेड बाय आचार्य सुश्रुता दैट मींस स शब्दम अपीडश्च ऊर्ध्वम उपेति एज वी नो व्हाइल रिड्यूसिंग एन एंटेरोसील द इंटेस्टाइन मूव्स बैक टू दी एब्डोमिनल कैविटी विद अ गर्गलिंग साउंड So here he is also saying that sa shabdam apirtascha urdham apeti. That means when you try to push it back, it moves inside with a gurgling sound as it is moved upwards. Urdham upeti and vimuktascha punaradhmayeti. That means and if you release that, it will again lead to this recurrence or coming of the intestines out of the abdominal cavity into the inguinal canal. Am antravridhim asadhyam iti chakshate. And this antravridhi is when it reaches the phalkosha or it forms a complete scrotal hernia complete vaginal hernia it is a asadhya kind of vyadhi next slide please so as we have seen acharya sushruta has very beautifully explained the etiology pathology clinical symptoms clinical the signs and the prognosis of the disease now coming to the management of the inguinal hernia so he says that varjyat antra hetuki that it should be treated after informed consent of the patient should be told about the prognosis aprapt phal koshayam vriddhi vat vriddhi kramo hetu that means if the hernia is still in the inguinal region it has not formed a complete scrotal hernia that means the hernial sac has not descended into the scrotum Vat vriddhi kramo hitav. That means the treatment which is told for the vrat vriddhi should be performed. What is that treatment? Tatra adito vat vriddho trayavrit snigdham aturam svinnam chayan yatha nyayam payet virechanam. That means the patient should be given snehad with the trayavrit sneh and after performing the swedan, what is the classical guidelines for performing the virechan should be performed. It should be performed using koshamra, which is a type of a mango, koshamra, tilvak, erand phal telani vanaram that means the patient should be given purgation with the koshamra tilvak or erand tel vanaram and if this cannot be given if the classical purgation cannot be given the patient should be given sakshiram va pibien masam telam erand sambhavam that means the patient should be given erand tel along with the milk for 1 month also tatkale anil gnanam vathe kalkeshcha buddhinam that means the niruhien nirudam That means the patient should be given niruhu vasti with the kalk vath vichar vatagna and after the niruhu vasti cha bhuktvantam rasodanam the patient should be given masras for drinking and after that yashti madhuk siddhen tatas telin yojet that means then the anuvasan vasti should be given with the yashti madhu siddh tel that this is the guideline for the management of a bubinoseal according to acharya sushruta which has not descended into the scrotum And next, if it has descended, what Acharya Sushruta has told, apraptafal koshyam vat vriddhi kramo heto tatraya vanshansthaam ta dehed ardhendu vakraya. That means if after this the results are non-satisfactory, then if the hernia is at the inguinal region itself, you should perform dehed ardhendu vakraya. That means agni karma should be done with ardhendu vakra shlaka. This shlaka is of a semi-lunar shape. According to me, this specially. Shalaka has been used as you know it is a semilunar type of shalaka having two sharp ends so probably it was used to cause agni karma at both deep inguinal ring and the superficial inguinal ring otherwise other the shalakas which has been told in early sutra sthana, if they are used, it can perform agnikarma only at one site. But this special use of the Ardhendu Vakra Shlaka, which has two mouths or the two points, is specially done to probably cause the fibrosis at both the deep inguinal ring and the superficial inguinal ring. That is what he says, goes to say onwards, that samyag avrodhartham kosh praptam tu varje. That means tatraya vankshanstham tam dahe ardhendu vakraya samyag avrodhartham. That means to avrod or to prohibit the progress of the disease into the scrotum, this agnikarma is performed with the ardhendru shalaka. Kosh praptam tu varje. That means if it reaches the phal kosha, it forms a complete scrotal hernia, then this ardhendu vakra shlaka agnikarma should not be performed. Then he goes on to explain certain radical treatments for which we don't have a present explanation at this time, and it can be a scope for the future studies or future investigations. What he says, that tvacham bhitvam angusht madhyam dahe cha ang viparyat. That means if a hernia is on the right side, then the skin on the greater toe of the left foot, that is on the greater toe of the left toe, should be inside, and then agnikarma should be done there. Ananem vidhadin vriddhi kafatmiko. That means the same vidhana should be performed from the vat kafaj vriddhi also. Pradehet prayata kintu snayu chedo adhikasto. That means in the vata and kafaj type of vriddhi, the burn or the chedan should be done a bit deep. Other than this, he told shankho aparich karnante tayakatva yatanen sevinam vayatastadvam shiram vidhed antra vriddhi nivritte. That means he advises the Sira Veda at Shankh Pradesh and the Karnant Pradesh. Probably he is talking about the posterior auricular vein or the superficial temporal vein, which should be incised for, which should be used for the Sira Veda. Next slide. So as we have seen in the treatment advocated by Acharya Sushruta, he is basically talking about the Vata Anuloman. He is well aware that if the patient develops constipation or if the apan vayu is not done anuloman, then at that time the patient may develop obstruction. That is why the treatment of the vat vriddhi, he is told again and again to perform the purgation for 1 month or perform the this classical purgation and to give the niru and the anuvasan vasti, and also he is advising the mass rest for the vat shaman. So basically the attempt is to avoid the constipation. As we have seen in the previous slides, it is the constipation, that is the intestinal obstruction caused because of the impaction of the feces, which give rise to the obstruction. And without obstruction, strangulation cannot occur. So if you can avoid the constipation in the patient, that will help in two ways. First of all, the patient will need not to strain while passing the stools. As he or she need not to strain while passing the stool, the extent of the hernia, that is the amount of the intestine which is coming out through the hernial orifice, will be reduced. And also, as the constipation will not be there, there will be proper movement of the feces, urine and the stools, filatus and the urine. The patient will not have a chance to develop the intestinal obstruction as a resultant of the constipation. So the main motto of Acharya Sushruta, or the main this guideline by Acharya Sushruta, is that avoid the constipation in the patient, allow the natural movement of the feces, flatus and the urine in order to prevent the complications of the hernia. So that is our take home message. So hernia is a surgical disorder which should always be operated under feasible circumstances. Obstruction and strangulation are the surgical emergencies. A reducible hernia can be easily managed and can be prevented from converting into irreducible hernia or the obstructed hernia if the patient does not strain too much or if he does not have any obstruction to the movement of the flatus, feces and the urine. Emergence of the novel coronavirus and unsuitable subjects demands approaches for the delaying of the surgery or conservative management. So conservative management of the surgical disorders as described in Ayurvedic texts need more attention. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your wonderful presentation. Now, it's time for question discussions. There are a few questions from audience, sir.
Okay.
Mode of action of hernikarma in hernia.
Actually, this is a very, what you say, less researched topic that we don't have presently any logical explanation to the Agni Karma in the hernia. According to certain experts to whom I have spoken early, they say that as a resultant of the pain reflex by causing the Agni Karma at the Angushta Madhya, there may be the reducibility of the hernia may be enhanced as a resultant of the pain reflex, but the topic of the Sira Veda and the Agni Karma remains an open challenge for our Ayurvedic students to establish its efficacy in hernia. At present, we don't have any logical or a scientific explanation to the Agni Karma and the Sira Veda. These are just the classical references which we know at the present time.
Thank you, sir. How to differentiate?
One thing more I want to add. Excuse me. I want to add one thing more. As I have said in my slide, that Acharya Sushruta is using Ardh Hindu Vakra Shlaka. This shows that he was aware that the Agni Karma at the same time needs to be performed at the two places. And as a resultant of the Agni Karma, which may probably cause the eschar formation or the fibrosis, he was attempting to perform this Agni Karma simultaneously at the deep inguinal ring and the superficial inguinal ring. That is why he used a specifically made shlaka for this. Otherwise, he could have used any other kind of shlaka. So his goal was that, as he says, that samyag avrodham. That means if it is done properly, it may attain the samyag avrodham. That means it may attain the fibrosis, which may hasten the further progress of the disease. That means the hernia may not descend into a complete scrotal type of the hernia. Next.
So next question. How to differentiate indirect hernia from the hydrocele?
Yes, I have told earlier, the best test is for this is to get above the swelling. Inguinal scrotal swelling, it is not possible to get above the swelling. That means you have to hold the root of the scrotum with the thumb and your two finger, index and the middle finger. Thumb should be placed anteriorly to the scrotum and the two fingers should be placed posteriorly. After that, the patient is asked to cough. If you can feel a thrill or your thumb and finger expands, that shows it is an inguinal scrotal swelling or an indirect hernia, because direct hernia will not descend into the scrotum. It will continue as a forward bulge or behind the spermatic cord or above the spermatic cord at the superficial inguinal ring. It is only the indirect hernia which descends into the scrotum. So a hydrocele, you will be able to get above the swelling. As the hydrocele, the fluid is contained inside the two layers of the tunica vaginalis. It is not going up to the into the inguinal region. Whereas in the indirect hernia, there will be contents which will be coming in between your thumb and the two fingers. So as you ask the patient to cough, there will be an expansile cough impulse. Whereas in the case of hydrocele, there will be no such findings.
Thank you, sir. Yes. Another question, what food should avoid with an inguinal hernia?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
What food should be taken?
So as such, there is no clear-cut guidance for the what food should be avoided. But as we have seen from our this pathology, those foods which causes the constipation, that is the unrefined foods which are less in fibers, more refined foods, they should be avoided. More wholesome diets should be prescribed to the patient for the proper regulation of the feces. More water should be advised. The patient should be advised to take more water and avoid the foods which can cause the constipation. We all are well aware of those. Non-vegetarian items should be avoided for that also.
So another question. What are the causes of congenital weakness of abdominal muscles and what are the management?
Okay. As we have read the anatomy of the inguinal canal, there I forgot to mention one point. Why this inguinal hernia occurs, or what causes the weakness in the abdominal wall which causes the inguinal hernia? That is the presence of the inguinal canal itself, and the presence of the deep inguinal ring and the superficial inguinal ring itself is the cause for the formation of the weakness of the inguinal inguinal hernia, that is weakness of the abdominal muscles at this place in the groin region. Specifically in the case of the congenital weakness, as we all know that while the descent of the testis is occurring place, the testis in the embryo or in the fetus is located inside the abdomen. They are intra-abdominal. By fifth to sixth month of the gestation, they start moving from the, first they are formed at the lumbar vertebral region, then they move to the deep inguinal ring. They stay there for the 1 or 2 months. At the end of the 8th to 9th month, they passes from the the inguinal canal into the scrotum by the action of the gubernaculum. And while they are descending from the abdomen to the inguinal canal and then to the scrotum, they drag with them the part of the peritoneum, which is called as the processus vaginalis. So this processus vaginalis ultimately fuses by the 8th and 9th month. The fusion takes place first at the deep inguinal ring. Second fusion takes place of this processus vaginalis at the just above the testis, in the tunica vaginalis, just above the testis. And the third fusion takes place inside the inguinal canal by the formation of a fibrous cord. If there is failure of any of the fusion or all of the fusion, either all the three types of fusions may be failed or there may be single fusion failure at the deep inguinal ring. If it is just a single fusion failure at the deep inguinal ring, the area will be open from the superficial inguinal, the area will be open from the deep inguinal ring to the superficial inguinal ring. That means there will be a defect, a congenital defect, that is a communication between the abdominal cavity and the inguinal canal. So this forms the congenital weakness, that is the persistence of the processus vaginalis. That is, the processus vaginalis fails to occlude, which gives rise to the congenital time of the weakness. Other example is the immaturation of the umbilical scar. As you know, the vitellointestinal duct and the umbilical cord is connected through the umbilicus. After the shedding of the umbilical cord, if the umbilicus scar does not mature, it can lead to the umbilical hernia, or it can cause a hernia at the time of the birth itself if the scar is big or the defect is big inside the umbilicus. So these are the two basic causes for the congenital weakness.
The next question. Sir, would you please justify the Sravada and inguinal hernia?
As I have repeated that there is no classical justification, there is no modern justification available for the Sravada, and personally, and I have not seen anyone performing this Agni Karma and the Sravada in this hernia. This is a matter of research which should be taken, and at this time, if our institutes come forward and take these patients, because the patients are not themselves willing for surgery, they are searching for the conservative treatments, these can be tried, but presently, sorry, I don't have any valid explanation for the Sravada in this.
Sir, next question. Chance of recurrence after the Agni Karma.
Again, same question. The Agni Karma is usually not performed these days. So we don't have any data for the recurrence, how much patient will have recurrence or not.
Okay, sir, next question. Is there any chance of recurrence of hernia in congenital weakness of abdominal muscle, and how you can manage it?
Okay, so basically there is very less chances of recurrence if it is done at an early age. If you feel that if the patient is coming to you, a younger adult is coming to you, and if the clinician assesses that the patient's posterior wall musculature is weak, then the surgeon may go for the hernioplasty. If the patient goes for the hernioplasty, then the chances of recurrence is less than 5%. The recurrence in the cases of hernioplasty takes place only if the mesh gets infected. If the mesh gets infected, at that time the mesh needs to be removed and it may lead to the recurrent hernia. Or if there is a failure of the proper wound closure, at that time hernia may be caused. And most of the time hernia, the recurrence in the patients of the indirect hernia, it will be a kind of a direct hernia. Usually if you have operated for the indirect hernia and not perform the posterior wall repair, either by the Bassanese repair or the shoulder repair or hernioplasty, at that time it may lead to formation of a direct hernia on a later date.
So next question, management of incisional hernia in Ayurveda.
Ayurveda as it is has not explained the incisional hernia. The treatment principle remains the same, avoid the strangulation. Best incisional hernia is treated through the surgery itself, and the choice of surgery is the hernioplasty. But for the time being in present era, the patient can be treated safely if the patient is not allowed to go into the stage of obstruction or strangulation, as we have read earlier by the principles of the Ayurveda, which includes Vata Anulomana, softening of the stools and avoiding the straining during micturation. And obviously the Nidana Parivarjana. Patient should not keep on lifting the heavy weight and all the nidanas which have been told, and the comorbidities like the bronchitis or the tuberculosis should be treated in those patients.
The next question, sir, if the patient is unfit or old age for surgery, then what is the conservative or palliative treatment for
that treatment is same, the conservative and the palliative treatment is same. If the patient is unfit or old age, if the patient can be is intelligent enough to follow the guidelines of the surgeon, the treatment and the hernia is reducible, press can be tried on that patient. Along with that, stool softening, vatanulomana treatment, and the stool softeners can be avoided, prescribed to the patient. The principle of management remains same, the conservative principle remains same. I want to repeat, the patient should not be allowed to progress into a stage of the obstruction. Obstruction is being caused because of the heart stools getting causing the occlusion of the intestinal lumen. So if the patient still, even after the medication, patient still complains of the constipation, or he or she needs to strain for the passage of the stool, then definitely the bastis can be given for the malashodhana. Next.
So last question of the session. What care should be taken in younger age, operated inguinal hernia at the age of 2 months?
Okay, the care is not, there is no specific care if the patient has been operated at the 2 months. Usually the patient will recover well from the surgery. The only care is that the child should be not allowed to develop whooping cough in the literage. That if the patient child is having any other comorbidity like the cyclic vomiting syndrome or the whooping cough, it should be treated emergently, and the child should not be allowed to develop the constipation. If these three, that is the cough, vomiting and the constipation, can be avoided in the child should not have any kind of problem in the future.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for herniation of your knowledge with us, sir.
Thank you.
Before going to LDT function, we need a few words from your side, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. First of all, I would like to thank all the management of the Gramin Ayurvedic Medical College, Derdal, the Department of Shalya Tantra, and the co-organizers for giving me the chance or this honor to speak in the learned people like you. Before I sum up, I just want to repeat a few words of my guide, Dr. Muralidhar Sharma, sir, which are still inside my mind when I was in my PG. The shloka which I have told, that dvivid vyadhi shastra sadhya snehadi kriya sadhya shastra sadhya snehadi kriya na pratishidyate snehadi kriya sadhya shastra karam na kriya. He used to say that when I ask him, sir, what is the scope of the surgeons, Ayurvedic surgeons, in this present era when the modern surgery has progressed so much, what we have to offer. So he told me, I'm just repeating his words, and I think the budding surgeons will take these words in their life. He told me that there is a great debate in the modern surgery about the preemptive surgery. Preemptive surgery is that where before the onset of the surgery, onset of the disease, the surgery is performed. The most famous example being of that, the Angelina Jolie, where just because her mother was diagnosed with the breast cancer and she was diagnosed with BRAC gene, that is the gene BRCA1 and BRCA2. These are the two genes responsible for causing the breast cancer. So she got her breast removed. So he told me that at this time, the need for the Ayurvedic surgeons is that to provide the conservative approaches to the surgical disorders. And he used to treat many patients who were coming for the surgery with just these simple treatment protocols. So I would like to say that, and sum up that, there are many things in Ayurveda which can be used in the present era to avoid surgery in the patient because of the risk of the acquiring of the COVID in the patients and also the surgeons. So my take home message from my side and my words in this session will be that always try to find the conservative approaches for the surgical management when they can be tried. But if it is a case of an emergency surgery, as we have read in the obstructed hernia or strangulated hernia, surgery should be done. That is the timing of the surgery is of utmost important. That means whether we choose to delay this or we choose to perform in an emergency basis. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for being with us. Now we'll move for the LDT function.
Unmute.
सुदर्शनाय वासुदेवाय धन्वंतरये अमृतकलशहस्ताय सर्वभय विनाशाय सर्वरोग निवारणाय त्रैलोक्यपतये त्रैलोक्यनिधये श्री महाविष्णु स्वरूप श्री धन्वंतर स्वरूप श्री 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 औषध चक्र नारायणाय स्वाहा। नमो भगवते महासुदर्शनाय वासुदेवाय धन्वंतरये अमृतकलशहस्ताय सर्वभय विनाशाय सर्वरोग निवारणाय त्रैलोक्यपतये त्रैलोक्यनिधये श्री महाविष्णु स्वरूप श्री धन्वंतरि स्वरूप श्री 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 औषध चक्र नारायणाय स्वाहा।
Thank you for prayer song. Now I request Chai ma'am for a welcome speech.
Good afternoon, all. Myself, Dr. Chaya Hule, Assistant Professor, Department of Rog Nidana, Gramin Ayurvedic Medical College, Tedda. First, I would like to welcome our chief patrons of this webinar, Sri D.C. Patil Sir, Chairman, GMC Tedda, Dr. J.B. Albur Sir, Secretary, GMC Tedda, Sri Nilesh J. Desai Sir, Treasurer, Gramin Ayurvedic Medical College, Tedda. On behalf of entire institute, I would like to welcome e-valedictory chief guest Dr. S.K. Bannigur sir, Dean, Ayush Department, Rajiv Gandhi University, Bangalore, and principal of Sanjeevani Ayurveda Medical College, Hubli. I would like to welcome our college principal sir, Dr. L.M. Virada. I would like to welcome organizing secretary of this webinar, Dr. Taj N. Dangarnav sir, Associate Professor and HOD, Department of Shalya Tantra, Gramin Ayurvedic Medical College, Tedda. I would like to welcome Dr. M.H. Kulkarni sir, Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Sri Jejiko Ayurveda Medical College, Ghataprabha. I would like to welcome Dr. Kishore Kumar Hulatti sir, Professor and HOD, Department of Shalya Tantra, Shushruta Ayurvedic Medical College. Dr. Yogesh Kulkarni sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, BVVS Ayurveda Medical College, Bagalkot. Dr. Sharad Kulkarni sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Indian Institute of Ayurveda Medicine and Research, Bangalore. I would like to welcome Dr. Amruta Wali Madam, Associate Professor, Department of PG Studies in Prasuti Tantra, KLE Academy of Higher Education, Sri BM Kankanwadi Ayurveda Medical College, Belagavi. Dr. Supran Sharma sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Jammu Institute of Ayurveda and Research, Jammu. I would like to welcome our teaching staff, non-teaching staff, hospital staff, students of Grameen Ayurveda Medical College, Devda. I would like to welcome faculty members, practitioners, UG students and PG scholars of different colleges and audience from different parts of country. I welcome you all.
Thank you, ma'am, for welcome speech. I request our beloved principal for watering the plant. Thank you. Now it's time for valedictory speech. I request Dr. S.K. Banigal sir, Dean of Ayush, Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Science, Bangalore, and Principal of Sanjivani Ayurvedic Medical College. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon to all. I am extremely happy that an update Shalya Tantra 2020 a 3 days webinar was successfully conducted, for which I congratulate all the management persons of your this Grameen Ayurveda Medical College Devdar, principal and all the faculty members for this successful conduction. I also congratulate all the 6 resource persons who put forth their views regarding the various practical aspects of Ayurvedic Shalya Tantra. And I had an opportunity of listening to some of the presentations also. I felt that all these presentations were very helpful, and all the resource persons have shared their practical knowledge. And in this particular Shalya Tantra update,
The topics which were covered were of utmost importance, and they are helpful for all those even private practitioners also. The common parasurgical procedures like Agnikarma, Kshara-karma, especially Kshara-sutra, both in fistula as well as the pyelonidal sinus, and regarding inguinal hernia, and the presentation of ulcers in the lower limbs. So all these presentations were of utmost importance, and we usually encounter all these practice in our general practice. The topic ulcer of the lower limbs, it was in particular, but in generally, Vruna is being the most important topic in Shalya Tantra. As Jwara is most important topic in Kaya Chikitsa, and Atisara is most important topic in Kaumari Bhritya, in the same way, Vruna is the most important topic in Shalya Tantra. In Ashtanga Hridaya, at the beginning itself, he mentions that Sarvasya cha Shalyasya Vrunam Falatvat Evam Vrunam Adav Vicharyate. Whatever the type of Shalya, Shalya Tantra leads with the various types of Shalyas. All these Shalyas, or whatever the Shalya Karma, Anushalya Karma, if we perform, ultimately it results into formation of an Vruna. So, Vruna being the most important subject, hence, one who has to become an expert in Shalya Tantra, he must be well acquainted with the diagnosis, complications, and management of Vruna. So, in all these things, he should be an expert. And the Vruna being one subject in this particular Shalya Tantra update, it gave a very good information to all the participants. Secondly, the Shalya Tantra is basically, even though the surgical oriented, Shushruta has given more emphasis on the various surgical procedures, but his option of surgery was at the end. If we look into the surgical interference or intervention in Ashmari, he mentioned that akriyayam bhavet mrityuhu, kriyayam samshayo bhavet. Now, if I doesn't perform surgical procedure, the patient will definitely die. But if we perform the surgical procedure, the patient may survive. So, it was a last option, and it was many times, barring this particular statement, the surgical procedure which Sushruta had mentioned is inclusive of preventive, curative, as well as palliative. So, various types of palliative surgical procedures and curative surgical procedures and preventive surgical procedures have been explained by Sushruta. But the speciality of Ayurveda Shalya Tantra is the description of parasurgical procedures. These parasurgical procedures mainly are of Kshara-karma, Agni-karma, and Rakta-mokshana. So, whenever any disease or the patient is not fit for surgical procedure, we have other options of parasurgical procedures like Kshara-karma, Agni-karma, and Rakta-mokshana. And all these three procedures are elaborately explained. If you look into the explanation, it clearly indicates that these procedures were in extensive practice in those days. Even the minutest observations are recorded and they have been documented in the form of Sushruta Samhita. In a nutshell, I would like to say that this present 3 days Shalya Tantra update and the experiential knowledge which have been given by all the six resource persons has given lot of hope, confidence to all our young PG scholars of Shalya Tantra, undergraduate students, as well as to the general practitioners. These procedures, whether it is Rakta Mokshana, Agnikarma, or Chara Sutra, or Chara Karma, all are day care procedures. And they doesn't require any such type of very sophisticated establishment. If you have a very sophisticated establishment, it is well and good. Even if you don't have, even in your simple OPD room, OPD, these procedures can be followed. Particularly, Chara Sutra, as you know, it has been already popularized. And the treatment protocol has been well documented. Its efficacy in various innovative disorders, including Arsha and Bhagandara, has been established. And the other commonest indication which has been dealt by Dr. Sharad Kulkarni, that is in a pyelonidal sinus. So this is also, in this condition also, it is of more helpful. How this Chara Sutra is an upper hand compared to surgical procedure, which has been already dealt, I would like to add one or two points that Chara Sutra in situ, either in pyelonidal sinus or in the fistulae, you know, it gives a adequate drainage of the pus, continuous drainage of the pus. Cutting and healing are taking place simultaneously. And apart from all these things, why there is no recurrence of fistula or the pyelonidal sinus when it is treated by Chara Sutra is the wound after cutting, it heals from the bottom. That is most important. Whenever it heals from the bottom, it doesn't use any residual secretions to settle down and form once again abscess if it is healed from the from up, both the wound flaps are joining and giving in space in between. That space gives rise to scope for the accumulation of the discharges, hence there will be recurrences. So the most important and beauty of this Chara Sutra is it allows the wound from heal from the bottom so that the chances of recurrence is nullified in this particular procedure of Chara Sutra. And as well as in a fistula or in a sinus, if any ramifications are there, and these ramifications are effectively dealt by the effect of Chara, which has been applied on Chara Sutra, and because Chara has got a Prasarana Shilata guna, it spreads. So if any ramifications are there, Chara penetrates into that ramifications also, and it gives a good result of healing, as well as there are no chances of recurrence. Coming to the Agnikarma procedure, as you know, this Agnikarma, when Sushruta mentioned it in the first sentence, he mentions that Agni Chara Garyasu Kriyasu. The procedure of performing Agnikarma is very easy. The meaning of Agnikarma is Agni is transferred to the diseased area directly or indirectly by using any equipment. So Agni is transferred to that area. Now, in practice, we are performing Agnikarma in such conditions where there is the basic pathology involved is of Srota Vaigunya. There is some Srota Vaigunyata is there, like there is a Granthi or there is a Charmakira or there is a kadara. So where, or it is a granthi, charmakila or arbuda. So where there is a dhatu vaishamya is there, that is also because of the dosha vishesham. And this dhatu vishesha, dhatu vaishamya, which is in the form of a kachinata or granthi or sandhata of doshas and dhatus, that is destroyed by directly applying the heated shalaka on that particular area. And in other conditions, like where actually there is no dhatu vaisham is present, like sandhishula, rudrasri, in such conditions where neuralgia, trigeminal neuralgia, various neuralgias are there, if binduvat agnikarma is done at the root of the nerve from which there is a pain, radiating pain is there, so if you perform there, then it stimulates and instantly pain relieving effects are there. So it is practically seen. Now regarding the how the agnikarma works, its karmukata, it is still under study, and various research papers have been published that how actually this agnikarma gives a good relief as a pain management and other in other conditions also. Hence now there is a lot of scope for research in agnikarma, as well as this can be very easily incorporated in our general practice. Coming to another parasurgical procedure, that is raktamokshana. As you know, there are 5 types of raktamokshana, including prachanna, siravyada, jalavkavacharna, alabo and shangravacharna. The maximum procedure which is now in practice is performing raktamokshana by using jalokas. The scholars of Ayurveda or the rishis of Ayurveda were very keenly watching the nature. So they were watching the in the nature, they found that there is one jaloka which is having the capacity of sucking the blood. So they thought that why this should not be used as a therapeutic procedure, that in various rakta doshita vikaras, so if we allow the jaloka to bite there and it sucks the vitiated blood and it gives the result, they experimented and they got the result, they documented. So jalavakavacharana is once again is becoming a very popular therapy, like they call it as a leash therapy. So now it has been found that the saliva of jaloka contains various constituencies, starting from anesthetic type of substance is there. That's why when jaloka bites us, we don't feel the pain of the biting, because it has got an anesthetic type of secretion is there in the saliva. Substance is present in the saliva, so it has got an antibiotic type of substance. It has got an anticoagulant substance. So because of this, the jaloka gives a very good results in the various conditions. Now, in foreign countries, whenever the wound is not healing, there's a dushtavruna, non-healing ulceration is there, even on the diabetic wound, madhumehajanya vruna, or when the skin grafting is done, the surgeon feels that the grafting is being rejected, he feels that means the circulation is not established. So under such conditions, if application of jalavakavacharana, it increases the microcirculation, it enhances the formation of blood capillaries, angiogenesis. So because of all these effects in the such chronic wounds and diabetic wound, if the skin grafting is going to fail you, under such condition jaloka is of great helpful. So with all these parasurgical procedures and surgical procedures which are in use, even today we can practically use it and give relief to the patients where there is no answer from the modern surgical procedure. For your information, the modern surgical procedure nowadays has been changed a lot, and they are coming back to minimal surgical inventions. Like they are doing, instead of giving a very lengthy wound and taking an incision, making it. So they are turned into laparoscopic surgical procedure. So this is they are also thinking and coming to some minimizing the surgical conventional surgical procedure in minimizing the hospital stay. So they are going for this surgical procedure. Laser therapy is nothing but a beam of heat, electricity, heat is transmitted. This is again a sort of an agnikarma itself. We call it agnikarma, we call it as an macro agnikarma and micro agnikarma. Direct agnikarma and indirect agnikarma, all these references are there. It is a sort of an micro indirect agnikarma where this heat is transferred to one particular area. And if you want to burn it, that particular area is burnt. If you want to cut it, that particular area is cut. It is excised. So these are all the modern inventions based on the Ayurvedic principles. Hence, my sincere request to all the PG students, UG students, and the faculty who are dealing with Ayurvedic surgery, they go into the depth of the subject and see that such things are highlighted and they can be presented for the better use of the general practitioners. And off late, even the WHO is of the opinion that we have to minimize the surgical intervention. When absolute necessity is there, okay, we have to minimize the surgical procedure as far as possible. The statement is that management of surgical diseases by medical management. So that is the thing. So various diseases like Ashmari, Mutrasthila, that is benign hypertrophy of the prostate. So all these, even though they are surgical procedures, now they have been managed by medical treatment, Aushadhi Chikitsa. So Shastra Chikitsa, it should be the last option. And as far as possible, even though the disease is fit for surgical intervention, we have to first try by giving medical treatment, that too under the, because Sneha Kriya Sadhya Rogas and Shastra Kriya Sadhya Rogas are there. My counterpart from the Kaya Chikitsa and Panchakarma should not take it otherwise. A surgeon can practice both Sneha Kriya Sadhya Vyadhis as well as Shastra Kriya Sadhya Vyadhis. Whereas a Kaya Chikitsa and other plant subjects, they can practice only Snehadi Kriya Sadhya Vyadhis, not Shastra Kriya Sadhya Vyadhis. So, Ayurvedic surgeon is also an expert, should be expert in medical management. Now, for example, another example is the peptic ulcer. Now, where is the surgical procedure performed nowadays for this thing? Then, that's why even in peptic ulcer, only the medical management has been employed. So, that is the management of surgical diseases by medicines is mostly dealt in Ayurvedic surgical practice rather than the modern medical practice. With these few words, I once again congratulate the management and all the participants, principal and all his faculty members, all the resource persons for conducting the Shalya Tantra update and giving an hope and confidence to practice Shalya Tantra. And by doing this, we are helping the sufferers of the suffering human beings by and large. Thank you. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to be amongst you as a guest in the valedictory function. I extend my sincere gratitude to the management, principal and staff of Grameen Ayurved Medical College. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your sharing great knowledge and your experience, sir. Now it's time for organizing speech. I'll request Dr. Taj N. Dongaram, sir, for the organizing speech. Thank you. Sir, your voice is not audible, sir. Please unmute your microphone.
Okay. Good afternoon to everyone. Is it audible now?
Yes, sir. Audible, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon to everyone. Myself, Dr. Taj Ahmed Dongargaon, HOD Department of Shalya Tantra, GAM Sitherdal. Warm and graceful afternoon to our most valued Honorable Chief Guest, Dr. S.K. Bannigol, sir. Management Committee Chairman, Dr. D.C. Patil, sir. Secretary, Dr. J.B. Algur, sir. Treasurer, Sri Nilesh Desai, sir. Our beloved principal, Dr. L.M. Biradar, sir. And all the faculty members, teaching and non-teaching staff, and my dear friends, and everyone gathered here. And regarding this webinar, as our principal sir said, told me to conduct a webinar from our Shalya Tantra department, as it is a consecutive of Madhumeha from the department of Kaya Chikitsa. I felt very happy to make this webinar successful and started searching the resource persons initially. And I have contacted these six presenters I have contacted, and without any haste or without any second opinion, they have agreed for presenting in our webinar. Speakers, Dr. N. H. Kulkarni, sir, Dr. Kishore Ulati, sir, Dr. Sharad Kulkarni, sir, Dr. Yogesh Kulkarni, sir, and Dr. Amruta Madam, Dr. Sukran Sharma, sir. And if you see the speakers, as sir said, Manigol, sir, except Dr. N. H. Kulkarni, sir, and Kishore Ulati, sir, other all the four speakers are very youngsters. The mainly intention was to make the webinar successful even by taking the youngsters. And I have not contacted senior most people, as it is a usual practice in many of the conferences to call the well-known personalities. And I have myself, I have felt that well-known speakers used to keep the PPT ready all the time, and they present and they update it a little bit, and they present everywhere. So, but if you see the speakers of this webinar, speakers have prepared themselves and presented what they have really doing in their practice, which makes the budding doctors or else even the practitioners to adopt it in their routine life. So we have made the various committees to conduct this webinar. And if you see the GMC Sitherdal, being in a very village area, but we have received all the support facilities from the management, principal sir, to conduct the webinar successfully. As per the requirements, we have prepared the registration forms, posters, certificates, and feedbacks forms, and so on. Without any technical person to conduct the webinar, our college, Dr. Vinayak Mali sir, K.V. Hullur madam, and Dr. Chaya Hullur madam has prepared everything, and we have tried our level best in making this webinar successfully. And I agreed that one mistake we have made, and we have lately sent the one-click login IDs, and which made the delegates to join by late or else by missing the session too. And being an organizing secretary, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to our chief guest, Dr. S.K. Bannigol, sir, spared time from his busy schedule to grace the occasion. Today, we had an opportunity to hear, sir, your thoughts, and this will surely be going to encourage us in our future. As sir said, all the speakers and their contents as very clearly Bannigol, sir, has told. And mainly the intention was fulfilled. What we feel is the intention by keeping these topics is fulfilled by us. So it's my privilege to acknowledge all the speakers, Dr. N. H. Kulkarni, sir, Dr. Kishore Ulati, sir, Dr. Sharad Kulkarni, sir, Dr. Yogesh Kulkarni, sir, Dr. Amruta Wali, madam, and Dr. Shukran Sharma, sir, for accepting our requisition and gracing the occasion and sharing their valuable experiences and opinions in this webinar. A special mention to our respected principal, sir, L.M. Biradar, sir, for being the catalyst that stimulated us to do our best and standing as a pillar of strength with a deep sense of appreciation. Immense thankful to Dr. Vinayak Mali, sir, Dr. K.V. Kullur, madam, and Dr. Chaya Hullur, madam, and Dr. Sadalji, sir, for effort towards hosting the webinar so pleasantly. And I need to mention my deepest sense of appreciation. Finally, I would like to thank our even delegates, faculty members, and practitioners, PG scholars, and UG students for their patience listening, and mainly the following the all the webinar protocols by online and without making any disturbances or else they're all following the normal webinar protocols. This is what very important for successful conduction of the webinar. And I thank all the delegates and thank you one and all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I request Dr. L.M. Brother, sir, our principal, for the presidential speech.
Good afternoon, everybody. We, Sri Bhavakali Vidyapeeth J.V. Mandal's Grameena Ayurvedic Medical College, Deirdar, hosting this first national seminar on Advaita Shaiva Tantra from 22nd June to 24th June. So after the successful completion of Madhumeha 2020, an international webinar. So first of all, I would like to congratulate the chief patrons of our institute, Sri Arvind Doshi sir and Sri Kalapanna Avade sir, and other management committee members, Secretary sir, Dr. J.B. Alwar sir, and Sri Nilesh Desai sir, for their constant moral support for organizing all these events successfully. And I also congratulate the organizing secretary, Dr. Taj Ahmad Dongargaon sir, especially made his all the efforts to grant success of this seminar. And apart from that, I'm very much thankful to Sri S.K. Bannigol sir, Dean Ayush Department, Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences, Bengaluru, for their valedictory note and attending, sparing their valuable time with us at the valedictory function. And apart from this, I would like to thankful to all the speakers, those who shared their views in this Update Shailya Tantra online webinar, especially Dr. N.H. Kulkarni sir, Professor and Head of Department, Ghataprabha Ayurvedic Medical College, Dr. Kishore Kumar Ullati sir, Professor and Head of the Department, Shailya Tantra, Shushruta Ayurvedic Medical College, Prashanthi Kutira, SVS University, Bengaluru, Dr. Yogesh Kulkarni sir, Assistant Professor, PG in Shailya Tantra Department, Basheshwar Ayurvedic Medical College, Bagalkot, and Dr. Sharad Kulkarni sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Shailya Tantra, IIMR, Bengaluru, and Dr. Amruta Wale, Associate Professor, Department of Prasuti Tantra, KLA, Academy of Higher Education, Sri BMK Ayurvedic Medical College, Belagami, and Dr. Sukrant Sharma sir, Assistant Professor, PG Department of Shailya Tantra, Jammu Institute of Ayurveda and Research, Jammu, for sharing and delivering good knowledge with good topics in this online seminar, which is more helpful to all the practitioners, students, and PG scholars to upgrade their knowledges. And I am especially thanks to Dr. Vinayak Mali sir and Dr. Sampurna Kullur madam, coordinated this event very nicely without any technical errors. And apart from that, I also take this opportunity to thankful to all other staffs. Those are helpfully on the screen and off the screen. They helped all the teaching, non-teaching and other staffs of Grameena Ayurvedic Medical College for making this event grand success. So I, on behalf of management, I am very much thankful to all speakers, organizers, who and all the audience who have participated in this wonderful event. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I request Kullu ma'am for the vote of thanks.
Good afternoon to all. I thank our management and principal for giving me the opportunity to express my gratitude on this occasion. First of all, I would like to thank our chief patrons of this webinar, Sri D.C. Patil sir, chairman, and Dr. J.B. Albur sir, secretary, Sri Nilesh Desai sir, treasurer of Gramin Ayurvedic Medical College, Kerala, attending the function in spite of their busy schedules. On the behalf of entire institute, I would like to extend a special thanks to Dr. S.K. Bannigal sir, Dean Ayush Raju Gandhi University of Health Science, Bangalore, and Principal Sanjeevini Ayurvedic Medical College, Hubli. We have been fortunate to be assisted by our Principal, Dr. L.M. Biradar sir. You have given constant support and a lot of encouragement. Thank you, sir. I also thank Organizing Secretary of this webinar, Dr. Taj and Dungargam sir, Associate Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Gramina Ayurvedic Medical College. On the behalf of the entire institute, I would like to extend a special thanks to all chief speakers, Dr. N.H. Kulkarni sir, Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Sri Jejiko Ayurvedic Medical College, Ghataprabha, Dr. Kishore Kumar Ullati sir, Professor and HOD, Department of Shalya Tantra, Ayurvedic Medical College, Bangalore, Dr. Yogesh Kulkarni sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, BVVS, Ayurvedic Medical College, Bangalore. Thank you, sir. Dr. Sharar Kulkarni, Assistant Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Indian Institute of Ayurvedic Medicine and Research, Bangalore. And Dr. Amruta Wali Madam, Associate Professor, Department of PG Studies in Prasuti Tantra, KLE Academy of Higher Education, Sri BM Kankanwadi Ayurvedic Mahavidyalaya, Belagavi. Thank you, madam. Dr. Sukrut Sharma sir, Assistant Professor, Department of Shalya Tantra, Jammu, Institute of Ayurveda and Research. Thank you, sir. I would like to extend my thanks to our teaching staff, non-teaching staff, hospital staff, and students of GMC Tirtha. Last but not least, I would like to thank all the faculty members, practitioners, UG students, PG scholars of different colleges, and audience from different parts of the country for showing their interest in webinar. I am once again thanking to make this webinar successful. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. We send the feedback form in all the group and to your email. Kindly fill up and send it back. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.